welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yeah. Phone number 866-901-ADAM, 866-6-NICKS. 901-ADAM. We're going to play a little something called Rich Man, Poor Man. Yeah, I got to start talking earlier, I realize. You know, I get up. It's a very, it's a solitary activity. It's not like over at Bruskett's house where he walks down and it's like he's going into an IHOP. Wife down there, up at 2:15.
Oh, no, she Belgium shakes him waffles. Out of bed, believe me. Before she goes down to take care of her duties as cook, she also has to be the concierge and wake him up.
I know she wakes him up at about 1:45, walks him over to the toilet, massages his bladder until urine comes out, and then she actually she catches it in her cupped hands. I don't know how she disposes of it.
Go ahead and make honey.
Then maybe she saves it.
It's all voluntary. But
the point is,
I'm tired. I don't want to go to work today. To hell with Carolla.
Goes down.
It's pretty close.
My buddy Johnny Hands is funnier than Carolla anyway.
Johnny Hands.
When he gets out of juvie,
Pete
I'm
going to
see
maybe.
About getting him on the show.
It's a great show. A lot of fun.
Point is I come down, there's nobody, the house, it's never quieter than the wee hours, you know, it's weird, but you know, 1:30, 2 a.m., there's still some life outdoors, you know, 4:30 in the morning, there's zero going on. I don't know, somebody should pick the time, and there is one, and it probably varies from city to city, but when it is the quietest. You know, if you live in Manhattan, it's not that quiet at 2:30 or 3 in the morning. It's probably more quiet at 4:30 or 5 That's than right. it is people walking home from bars and stuff like that. But the point is it's never more quiet. I go down, I make myself my breakfast. If I cook, my dog will come down and join me. If I eat cold breakfast, my dog will pass. That's the way it works. The dog.
The dog's a snob.
The dog. Well, you know, the thing about dogs is, dogs are like people, how people start. They're pure. They're like kids.
Right.
Kids just want stuff, you know, and you that's what you have to do. You have to break them. You have to say, look, you have your M&Ms. Now let Timmy have his M&Ms. How would you like it if Timmy took your M&Ms and his? You have to keep beating that into kids because kids are essentially just animals, which dogs are, and they're number one. I mean, everyone's born on this planet. Here's a news flash. Everyone here is put here to look after number one. That's how we start. And then you get broken. You get broken by society, by family, by good parenting, by churches, by police. You are essentially broken. Dogs are never really broken. I mean, they can learn not to crap in the house and they can, you know, learn not to dig up things. But that's just because you have to reward them or punish them when they do it. But when you just leave them alone, so my dog does. My dog sleeps on the foot of our bed, sleeps upstairs. The kitchen is not close to the bedroom. I'm happy to say I go. It's bad when it's in the same room, like when I used to live in that single in Hollywood. Point is. I go downstairs 3 days a week. I pour a bowl of cereal, and then the other 2 days a week, I fry up some eggs, maybe make some bacon. If I turn on the stove, the dog is down. If it hears the rattle of a pan, it's down. If it hears the rice checks going in the bowl with the soy silk milk, not interested, and will not come down.
Do you share it? You know, a little bacon.
Yes, I do. I reward the dog, and that's you know, he then makes the positive association with the rattling of the pots and pans. But the point is the dog comes down. Dog wags its tail, looks like it's there to greet me and everything. But it will exclusively only come down when I'm cooking, and never come down. Today I cooked, so Molly and I had a little quality time.
I like how you call
time.
Molly he.
Yeah.
Some people, you know, a lot of people get offended when a stranger calls their dog he. It's a she.
Yeah.
You call your own dog he.
Well, I believe, you know how all ships are she's?
Right. All dogs are
he's. And vessels, planes, ships are she's. All dogs are he's.
I like that because 90% of them are spayed or neutered anyway.
Yeah.
Thanks to Barker.
Might as well be a he.
Right.
Right. All right. Yeah, I think, well, you know what happens is I am so not into correcting people. I think Teresa said he at some point, and I just went along with it. It's good enough.
I think that is what happened.
I don't like to stop and go back and go, it's not a, I know you don't care. I don't even care. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's how people are motivated. We're talking about playing some rich man, poor man this morning. Now, how does this game work? I don't even know if it's quite a game, but a few years back, sitting over at the writer's table over at Jimmy Kimmel Live, I stumbled on this game, which is things that rich people and poor people share exclusively that the middle class really doesn't. Now, sometimes when you're trying to think of rich man, poor man, you can think of things that rich people and poor people all share. Or sometimes it's easier just to do the reverse math and think, well, the middle class doesn't do this. And it started with outdoor showers. I think that was the first one. Super rich people have an outdoor shower. When you're super poor, you might be taking a shower outside. Maybe it's with a bucket on a string or it's with a hose. Either way, the outdoor shower, rich and poor. But it kept going. And there are a lot of interesting additions to the list. I had ones like getting driven to the airport. When you're poor, you have to catch a ride to the airport because a cab is $33 and you can't afford it. When you're rich, you're driven to the airport via a chauffeur, a limousine, a town car. Middle class does the thing where they drive, they park, they get on the shuttle, and they go. Now, I don't know what class my family is when they actually go to another airport, not the airport they're leaving from. They actually go to the Van Nuys airport when they leave LAX. Maybe a separate category, but Dave had some good ones. You, Teresa, you pulled some off the website?
Yes, I'm very impressed with some of our message board.
I must say, I was completely prepared to be disappointed by the things that people contributed, and we've had some great ones.
Well, Garrett from Burbank, both a rich man and a poor man, if white, might have a secret black love child. You know, Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah.
And, you know, I thought
secret
that was
cool. Love child of color.
Right. And also, a rich family and a poor family will lie to police to cover up a murder usually committed by a young male family member.
That's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I like that one. Kevin from Palos Verdes has a pretty good one, too. Being a part of the armed forces. Rich man, Prince Andrew, you know, Niedermeyer and Animal House, and then Gomer Pyle and... poor 18-year-old kids who don't know any better than to fall for
mostly
President
poor,
Bush's.
But, yeah, I agree. The rich people put their kids through the ritual of it, but they never actually see any action.
I've got some from Randy in Seattle. These are very good. I don't know if you've addressed the trailer issue, but white trash. My dad, for example, lives in a trailer.
Wow.
And movie stars live in trailers much of the time.
Well, it's an interesting point. You never really thought about the movie stars, but spend time in trailers. Middle class, they're people I know from my middle class neighborhood growing up who probably have never, I know, for instance, my dad has never set foot in a trailer. He's never physically, I would bet you $20,000 he's never physically been inside a trailer because he's never been on a movie set, but he's never been so destitute that he actually had to live in one. Interesting.
All right. Janelle from San Diego, free food. Free meals. The rich people, you like, oh, what a thrill, Mr. Carolla, to have you in our restaurant. Please, I wouldn't take your money. And then bums, you know, they get it at the soup kitchen.
Well, they would take your money at the restaurant, but lots of events, lots of dinners and things like that. Yeah, you might get a few free drinks at a restaurant, but yeah, lots of things you go to where there's just food spread out, and then, yes, the soup kitchen. Wow.
Randy had another good one. Marrying your cousin, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. I believe Einstein married his cousin. And apparently poor people marry their cousins.
Interesting. Yeah, they're not so far apart. It's really just the money.
Yeah.
Other than that, they're
the
simpatico.
Yeah.
Iggy is on the phone. Iggy.
Hey, Adam. How you doing? Great show, man.
Good, thanks. You have a rich man, poor man?
Yeah. Crazy food. Crazy food. You have the hillbillies eating raccoons and all that good stuff, and then you have the really rich guy eating oysters and lobster and all that good stuff, so that's another one.
Yeah, exotic chow. A lot of folks eating their possum pie, and then you have the ones that are eating the stuff that's on the endangered species list and stuff that costs $1,500 an ounce. Yeah, there is that. We've talked about the whole outdoors thing. I mean, we've talked about hunting is something that rich people, I mean, rich people do it with dogs, and they go after foxes and things like that, or they go after big game on safari, and then poor people are just shooting at squirrels like Jed Clampett. He was shooting at some food. It's a good line. Then one day he was shooting at some food and up from the ground. They didn't even name the animal. He's just shooting at something he was going to eat.
I like that. Both rich and poor eat bottom feeding creatures.
Well, that's true too. Iggy,
can I say something else?
Yes.
Yeah, I was riding my bike home from work the other day, and I found myself singing Chi-Chi
Tame
song.
Oh,
yeah.
Don't you do that to me today.
Keep it up, Dave. Keep it up, Dave.
Well, thank you, but I wish I... It's not me you need to point the finger at. It's... I don't know if you've heard.
Chef Boyardee.
I don't know if you heard that the Sharks played last night up in Edmonton.
Uh-oh.
On the brink of elimination.
Mm-mm.
Are you okay?
Were they eliminated?
They're out.
Oh.
Chi-Chi's out. The dream is over.
Let me say this. A week ago, the Lakers are up 3-1, or something close to it, and the Sharks are up 2-0 or 3-0.
Mm-hmm.
Now it seems almost a lock. I don't know what the percentage is. These are two things we sort of hoped for. We wanted to see the Lakers and the Clippers play out here in Los Angeles. We want to see the Ducks and the Sharks play out here in Los Angeles.
Of course, to see Chi-Chi and Tamu. I thought everyone was on board with this. Tamu seemed excited about it. Mm-hmm. He's gotten to the finals. Mm-hmm. I've been doing my part singing songs about the possibilities. Chi-Chi, however, couldn't pull it through.
Seems like there's a 75% chance both of them would get to the next round. But the chances that neither one of them would get to the next round had to be in the single digits. And for the love of Christ, and this is why I've never hit a parlay in my life. This is exactly what happens. I mean, if somebody sat you down and said, you know, they move on, the Sharks move on, and the Lakers move on, and I'll give you odds on it, you would have bet everything you owned, right? Neither one of them.
Adam, this isn't about money right now. This is about heartbreak.
But it's a business, Dave. Don't kid yourself.
I had a dream. Chi-Chi and Tamu, and it's over. And I poured my heart into a song.
I smell a song.
Wow. Should we hear that, or is it too early?
It's too early.
Too soon.
Too soon.
I respect that, David.
I'll try to work myself up to it in an hour or so.
Okay. And, you know... Oh, actually, you should stop me on this one. And, Dave, you know, if you ever need anything, you got to jump in and stop me. Otherwise, it's going to get uncomfortable. David, you know, if you ever need anything.
Thank you for the offer. I appreciate it. We're trying, Tamu and I are both trying to press forward in these difficult times because Chi-Chi would want it.
That's the way I believe Chi-Chi
everything
would
happens
want
for
it.
A reason.
Mm-hmm. That's right. I love that one. Frank?
Hey, how's it going, Adam?
Good. You have a rich man, poor man?
Rich man, poor man thing. They both show off and over-exaggerate whatever they got.
Yeah, poor dudes wear a lot of flashy nugget watch, gold jewelry and stuff. Yeah, it is ironic when a guy climbs out of a $1,200 Ford Fiesta, but appears that he's wearing 17 grand worth of Rolex. It's fun. One time, I pulled up to some gas station in some horrible part of town. I think I was driving a Nissan Z, the new Z car. This was a couple years ago when you didn't see so many of them around. An old black guy got out of the car, got out his, which was, I didn't even know what it was because it was covered with rust, Bondo, and primer. He looked at the Z, said, "That's a hell of a car, but I'm a Ferrari man." As I looked at his Ford Ranchero that had five different colored doors on it, I thought, really, Ferrari? Are you team sponsored? How does this Ferrari fan go? Or can we all just be Ferrari men? That's the way it goes.
In his heart, he was a Ferrari man.
Yes. Yes, Gotti. The rich go big in Gotti.
Yeah.
The poor go big in Gotti. Mm-hmm.
That's true. There was another good one that had to do with financial, on the financial tip from the message boards. Super rich people file for bankruptcy, and so do poor people.
Yeah.
Like Donald Trump.
Yeah, others are trying to protect assets and real estate,
right.
And you know they owe millions of dollars, and it's a strategic move. Whereas the poor people, I know people that had $1,200, $1,300 Visa bills that they just couldn't handle and said, screw it, because when you have nothing, filing bankruptcy just sounds like a windfall. Like, well, look, I live in an apartment. I got a car I own. It's worth $1,500, and I own Visa I owe Visa $2,200. Screw it.
Well, yeah, and let me add to that quickly. Neither really pay taxes. The rich have a lot of tax shelters, and poor people, they just don't pay them year after year.
Yeah, I was going to go with you on that, except for I'm rich and I pay tons of taxes. David?
Yes, how you doing?
What's up?
Hey, both rich people and poor people can take naps in parks anytime they want to.
Trying to think. Now, the poor people, yeah. You mean rich guy, like, walking his dog, napping on a bench?
Yeah, they don't have to work.
Maybe outdoor naps.
Well, I'll say this. Yes. Here's what he's... Maybe this is what he's alluding to. Mm-hmm. Is like, you see that scene in movies a lot when, like, you know, Richard Gere. Like, you know, he's a stuffed shirt. Mm-hmm. But then he meets the nice lady, and she teaches him to relax in the park, and he takes his shoes and socks off and naps.
Yeah, feels the grass with his bare feet for the first time since he was a child.
Right.
Yeah, there's always that part in all those movies where Jennifer Aniston is going to teach the uptight executive how to live.
Yeah.
Where she comes and says, come on, we're going to lunch.
Yeah.
And he's like, what do you mean? I have a big board meeting coming up. Come on, we're going to eat lunch, and we're going to eat it in Central Park, and they have to go out during the day. And by the way, how come when they do this, and they do this every third romantic comedy, she's footloose and fancy free.
It's
she's a free spirit. He's buttoned down.
Yeah.
He's uptight. He's go by the numbers. Dot the I's and cross the T's guy. How come she always wins? Why doesn't he bring her over into his stuffy lifestyle? Look, sweetie pie, this pie in the sky fantasy, going to the park, that's all fair and good, but you want to go on vacation, do you not? You want to go to Monaco? You want to take a charter jet?
You know, remember how we got the Central Park? In this nice Jag?
Yeah.
You want to stay riding in this Jag or on the bus?
Let's
go. How do
you
prefer?
Alarm's going off at 5:30 tomorrow morning. Drink yourself a cup of coffee. Have some prescription meds and we're going to work. That's right. Wear flats. Let's go.
Even telling
never
her
works.
Shoes.
It never
shoes he even knows.
It never works. He always goes over to their side.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I love that movie with Ben Stiller.
Yep. I was just thinking of that one.
It was like, I would have loved to have been there when they pitched that movie. It was Ben Stiller and Jennifer Aniston, and he was an uptight insurance risk assessor. First off, it could be an invented job. I'm not so sure that
it's
this
a real
job,
but the metaphor
actually exists.
Yeah.
And he's sitting there going, oh man, this is very high risk behavior. And she's going on the streets of Manhattan and going, oh, I'll buy a hot dog off that cart. And he's going, do you know what the risk assessment is on that? Do you realize how many people have, oh, funny. I've never heard of such a premise.
That was Along Came Polly. And of course, this is one of the standard things in the movie where the woman loosens the guy up. She takes him out for Indian food.
Yes, but he gets gassy. He doesn't like spicy food. It's a metaphor for his life. Does anyone, when these scripts are going by, does anyone have the balls to raise their hand and go, listen, to the gods of all things that are effed out? Almost said it. Hasn't this script been written 472 times in the last 50 years of filmmaking? Is this completely and totally and utterly effed out? And what happens is now I know how films are made. The celebrities get attached and that's it. You get Jennifer Aniston and Ben Stiller attached and they will make a snuff film in my mom's basement. That's how they do it. That's how it works. So they just make the script anyway. The script is sort of neither here nor there. You have Ben Stiller and you have Jennifer Aniston. It's going to make a certain amount in theaters and on DVD and in ancillary markets. But does anyone ever raise their hand and go, listen, fellas, she's a talented actor, actress. He's talented as well. Oh, Philip Seymour Hoffman actually is in this movie, you know, year before he wins his Academy Award. We have some pretty good comedic talent here. How about we get him a script? How about, but people then chime in, oh, look, we'll make this movie anyway. It'll make money. Well, that's fine. But as long as we're making a movie, as long as we have the talent attached, Why doesn't someone crap out a halfway decent script that's not completely effed out from a premise standpoint? I mean, this seems like a parody. It seems like we're watching, Larry David watching his sitcom over on HBO, or watching, I'm trying to think of the late night parody show that used to be on. What's his
Fridays.
Name?
Fridays.
No. Television talk show. Larry Sanders.
Oh, yes.
Sorry. Thank you. I'll eventually come up with my own answers. I don't give good clues. I admit it. But it really seems like if you talked about that script, Along Came Polly, it would seem like it was a parody within another comedy. This is what you would say if you're making fun of, if you're watching Curb Your Enthusiasm and somebody was pitching Larry David a movie, a comedy, that's what he would pitch. It sounds like that. It doesn't actually sound like an actual movie. Thank you. All right, where'd I go? Where'd I go wrong? All right, we need to take a break, but hold on. Brad?
Yeah.
Rich man, poor man?
Yeah, actually, hey, while you were talking, I came up with another one, too. It's a bad movie. You know, the rich man okays it and makes it, you know, the earnest movie, and then the poor man actually enjoys it and watches it, you know?
Good point. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And the other one was raw food, you know? The rich man's eating that sushi at $100 a pop. And the other one is the poor man's eating the raw hot dog, you know?
So. Yeah.
Right.
Uncooked chow. That's right. It's,
exactly.
Yeah, it's good. I like that.
Can of beans.
Raw hot dogs. Yeah, can of beans. Yeah, super white trash kind of food. And then the other one is the exquisite stuff. The stuff is steak tartare and that kind of stuff. All right. I'm good. We'll take a quick one more. One more. I just got to see this one. Jeff?
Hey, how's it going?
Rich man, poor man?
Yeah, I was thinking hardcore drug usage and then the inevitable rehab.
Mmm, solid. Yeah, I think we touched on that at one point, but that's solid. I just got to talk to Darren. Darren? Rich man, poor man?
Hey, Adam.
What do you got?
Hey, rich man, poor man. Both, when they walk into places, get an immediate escort.
Mm-hmm. You mean escort as in the female escort?
No, negative. If you watch if a bum walks into the Hilton wearing, Safeway cellophane plastic bag shoes, he's got two guys on him immediately.
Right, right.
Security.
Right.
Exactly.
Right. Rich guy comes in, concierge comes running around the thing, or the maitre d', or the whoever. Oh, Mr. Fauntleroy. Yeah, so lovely to see you again. Have you lost weight? And the poor guy comes in, sir, can we help you? But they're standing in front of him. Yeah, they both command attention. Yeah, middle class guys can walk in and out of anything, and everyone leaves them alone. Interesting. Well, all strong. All great stuff. All right, we're going to take ourselves a break. Judge Hall, I should say Doug Hall, although Judge is a better name. Doug Hall, who's one of the judges on American Inventor. This is the guy who has invented 15,000 items that we all have in our homes at this moment. Is going to be in. Good, because I have some inventions to pitch him. Deaf Rat Guy coming in. Comedian Alan Covert coming in. He's the comedian who's in every single Adam Sandler movie. And we have our Gibson guitar contest to give away. We're going to give away $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar as well this morning. People are going to come in. They're going to rock out for the opportunity to win that Gibson guitar. My wife's calling.
I hear Tons we have bombshells. I hear Deaf Rat Guy's got a bombshell for us,
ooh,
too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, we'll hear that in the 7 o'clock hour. All right. All that coming up.
The Adam Carolla Show. Comedy, opinions, celebrities, news, sports, and so much more.
The Ed on the phone. Ed?
You guys got a new girl there, huh?
Yes.
What's her name?
Teresa.
Hello, Teresa.
Hi. Okay. I enjoy your reviews very much.
I like your news. You got some good news for me.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of The Adam Carolla Show.
We're going to play a spirited round of rich man, poor man. These are things that rich people and poor people have in common.
I think it's the Harley.
The middle class wife is saying, are you kidding, Herb? You're not getting a motorcycle. You have two kids and a mortgage to pay. Rich guy, the wife hopes the guy buys it on the bike. She what? Gets the whole estate. The poor chick gets backhanded if she ever brings anything up.
Neither tends their own yards themselves.
Yeah, that is exclusively the domain of the middle class.
Smoking cigarettes in the house.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The super rich, they have smoking rooms. And then the poor people will give their toddler drag off their Winston. Hmm. You know, it's the funniest thing about rich man, poor man is people call up with theirs. They get two syllables out. I put them on hold and then explain what they were thinking. I wonder if it was. I'm adding eating shrimp to that list. Poor people eat a lot of deep fried buckets of shrimp. Rich people eat a lot of shrimp cocktail. Say more shrimp consumed by the top and the bottom than the middle. Alan Covert is here.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
One of our earlier guests on the show, and it's a good sign that he decided to come back and join us and that we've been on long enough to have him back.
It was discussed that he was perhaps one of our favorite guests.
Oh, wow, twice that
I
was favorite.
It was quickly shot down, but it was brought up, I must say. I don't know who brought it up. I think we let them go.
The pressure's on.
Yes. No, we were pleasantly surprised the last time you're in here because Grandma's Boy, by the way, name of the movie out on DVD, on my sister's birthday, May 9th, just a week or so ago. I don't know if that was planned or don't tell me.
I won't.
I'll pretend it was and I'll tell her the good news. Alan came on a few months back, and Alan, I've seen in every single Adam Sandler movie, and I didn't know if you were actually funny in real life, though, in real time. And you've lost quite a bit of weight. I think we discussed that as well, right?
I think I put it back on since the last time.
Really? I don't think so.
Oh, I've had life changes, Adam. I got married. I got a kid on the way.
You really?
All in the last few months.
Wow. Yeah, nice job.
Congratulations.
Is this because, I was thinking about that, you're a part of the Sandler gang.
Well, Sandler had a baby and said everyone in the office had to have one as well.
Right.
That seems fair. And
he gets, no one else has fun if I don't.
Yeah, he's like, no, it's over. Everyone has a kid now.
Alan said, all right, and he yelled now.
Yeah, he said, so I just left the office, went and found a girl, got married.
Sure. And he said, well, Adam, I got one coming, 9 short months. He said, that's not soon enough, my brother.
Yeah, so I adopted one.
Smart.
Until I'm going to keep that one until mine arrives naturally, and then I'm going to give that one back.
Well, you know, Kimmel always had kids in a group of folks that didn't have kids, but I got to say this, never slowed him down. And I mean that as a tip of the hat to the K-man. Still was able to have a good time with his buddies. Nothing, you know, all above the board, but, you know, why do you... You don't die just because your kids are born.
Some people do.
Some do, but I'm going to put that on a placard above
the
two
of you. How long, Alan, until your kid comes along?
November.
Oh, November. So oh,
my kids will be
twins,
much.
Right.
My kids will be much older than yours because my kids are coming this month, or this or next month, early next month. Either way, when my kids are in the sixth grade, your kids.
We'll be right behind.
We'll be in the sixth grade. Yeah, but my kids will be a couple of weeks older. And
my kids,
clearly.
Actually, when your kids are in the sixth grade, mine will probably still be in about the fourth.
That's right. I hope you took 4 years off because I'd already done the math on holding my kids back 2 years. So I just want to make sure. My kids will be in the sixth grade. They'll be 16 and 17. So I just hope you
they
did the math
carpool,
on that.
They can carpool with mine.
It would be nice. Alan, I don't know. You want to play old rich man, poor man,
I think I have two.
All right. Let's hear them.
Old cars.
Mm.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, somebody wrote in. Someone named Adolfo wrote in on old cars. Adolfo?
Yeah, Adam, how's it going?
Good, yeah. So we've done multiple cars. Rich people have a garage filled with vintage, beautiful, collectible cars and old... And then poor people have the ones rusting out up on blocks on the lawn.
Exactly.
But old cars, yeah.
Yeah, the rich man has the restored and, like you said, the collection.
Right.
The poor guy can't afford anything better.
Yeah, yeah. And I would say almost old everything, really. Rich guys will live in old houses that are manors, turn
old
of the century,
clothes.
Whatever. Yeah, vintage.
Right.
Yeah, it's old when you're poor and it's vintage.
Right.
When you're rich.
When you're poor, you get it at Goodwill. When you're rich, you go down to Melrose.
Do you have another contribution?
More than one refrigerator at your house.
Wow.
Oh, that's really good.
Not necessarily working if you're poor.
Yeah. I think we brought up washing machine, which is if you have two or three dishwashers, you have arrived, or if two of them are rusting out in the yard, that is a very bad sign.
By the way, is it acceptable to have the name Adolfo? It's just the different version of Adolf.
Is he's the Spanish Hitler.
I know. I always find it sacrilegious when you hear ballplayers with the name Jesus.
Yeah,
I would imagine
weird.
Christians would be offended.
It's not like their name is Jesus.
See?
It's Jesus.
Right, and then Adolfo. It seems like that seems like a bad move by the parent. I think this is going to go to the booth.
Mean the refs are going under the hood?
I think the refs are going up
to the
booth.
So you're saying, is the play on the field?
The ruling on the field is that it's acceptable, I guess. Right. This is what the parents did. They went ahead and did it, but the guys
and
the refs.
Are we going to piggyback Jesus in on this one,
yes,
too?
Yes, let's do that. So the ruling on the field is that it's all right to do these things. Adolfo and Jesus and stuff. But the refs out from under the hood, though. He's coming to the center of the field. Let's hear how he says.
After further review, the ruling on the field is reversed.
No, so you can't do it anymore.
Unacceptable.
No more Adolfos or Jesuses.
And the Mexicans lose a timeout?
That's right.
Okay. Boy, they need them too, because let me tell you, we are going into the fourth quarter with that country, and they're way behind. Way behind. They are, I don't know if you have such a thing called hurry up offense, Mexico, but if you have a no huddle, now's the time to go to it. Just in life, in general, go to the no huddle. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to the border and scream, go to the no huddle. I worked with a guy when I used to install closets during my glory days when I was working with the born-again gangbangers installing closets at a Burbank. Beautiful industrial Burbank right next to the airport, a place called Always Better Closets, ABC. I used to work with a guy who was Filipino who was named Pogi. And I said, well, what is this pogi? What does pogi mean? And he said, oh, it means very handsome in Filipino. And everyone always chuckles. Oh, that's cute. That's nice. But aren't you an a-hole when you go back to the Philippines? Hey, very handsome. Is it weird?
Is he an ugly guy? Because then that's the sad irony.
It would have been nice, but he was cute, I got to say. But how did his parents know he was going to be a hottie? Mm-hmm. They didn't know. It was just a bundle of cells. All right. We need to take ourselves a little break.
Pogi Covert.
Pogi Covert. Yeah, do you have a name for the child?
Well, I was going to go with Adolfo.
Oh,
apparently,
sorry,
that
dude.
And Jesus are out.
This is uncomfortable.
But with the ref and my Jewish grandmother, I got to X that one out.
So if you're Jesus and you live in Mexico, you're Jesus.
Right.
You're just Jesus.
Sure. Doesn't that seem weird?
It does seem weird.
I've always thought
how
that
many
weird.
Muhammads are there?
Well, that's a good point,
touché.
Too.
You know.
Yeah. Not as many in Mexico, but yeah, I know what you're saying.
I think it's just we're a little more sensitive, I think.
Maybe that's it.
I'm naming my kid Buddha. Screw it.
Really?
Right.
All right, we'll take ourselves a break. Alan Covert here, Grandma's Boy, out on DVD as we speak. We'll play a little hypothetical question with Alan after this.
Can't get enough? Check out Adam on the web at adamcarolla.com.
I never got past high school math, so I'm not sure what pi is exactly, but any equation that involves dessert, in for.
Adam will never run out of opinions. The Adam Carolla Show.
Use your fireballs to blow a hole in that wall. Yeah, that's great. Go in there.
Okay. Is this a good or a bad guy?
That's a bad guy. He's a drug dealer. Kill him.
Oh, I hate violence, but drugs are bad.
Ooh, nice death spike.
Alan Covert here. Grandma's Boy. The unrated edition.
Oh, yeah.
Is out on DVD. Take it home and watch it. Are there boobies?
There were boobies in the rated version. So all I can say is monkey sex.
Boobie!
Wow.
Wow. Monkey on monkey or monkey human?
You'll have to find out. But there is a monkey. It is unrated.
Wow.
Do the math.
Forward to that.
Shirley Jones. All I'm saying is Shirley Jones is very dirty.
We're talking well. What else don't we know? Or do we know? How does that go? Tell us something I don't know. Is that how that goes?
Yeah. Tell me something I don't
know. I don't think I've said that since junior. Last time I said, tell me something I don't know, it was followed by, see with your eyes, not with your hands. Remember? You'd be holding your miniature football game, and someone would go, hey, could I see that? And you'd go, See with your eyes.
See, I went a whole different way. I thought it ended with that statement than you getting slapped by a girl.
That's where I went, too.
I swear, that's all I was saying. It was like, Carolla was grabby.
No, I didn't, exactly I didn't I grab boobies back then. But that people used to say if you were holding something, could I see that, dude? Could I see that? They wanted to grab it. Alan was telling us during the commercial that a cousin of his had a run-in with an alligator.
In Florida, like 3 weeks ago, I think.
Yeah, it's been all over the news. But I think the news sort of, I don't know, propagate this stuff. Once there's one story, there seems to be another. But women are getting killed and eaten by alligators.
Supposedly.
Supposedly, yes. I know you have your own theory about a serial killer loose in Florida.
Feeding body parts to gators. My cousin started the fight, though. He has an airboat, and he does a lot of stuff in the Everglades. And he was giving these rich people a tour. Mm-hmm. And he saw an alligator, and he thought he'd impress him, and he jumped in the water and grabbed it.
Wow.
And the gator bit his arm, and now he has a cast. He's from the redneck brave side of the family.
He kept the arm, and alligator chomped on?
He's 60-something years old, and he kept punching the gator, and he got away.
That's what they say. Awesome. You should punch the gator in its snout if you're ever in the clutches of a gator.
Well, it's tough to get to the tail, which is 18 feet away when in the mouth. The snout, conveniently, is the easiest place for you to punch. Yeah.
I hope they also say scream a lot, because that's what would happen with me.
Now, wait a second, though. So he gets bitten in the arm?
I think it was his left arm. And I had my dad emailed me the whole newspaper article.
And you have Jewish blood in you.
Yeah, well, not Ronnie.
The guy who fought the gator doesn't have any blood in him,
by the way. He's one of three brothers, Ronnie, Lonnie, and Donnie.
Oh, wow. So strong.
I love that on Newhart.
I got to tell you, I was trying to crunch some Jew numbers myself, and it wasn't adding up.
Yeah,
Florida, fan boat, wrestling alligators. What the hell?
No. They didn't retire to Florida. They've been there always. Whole different type of people.
Indigenous.
Well, Florida, yes. We were saying Florida is kind of a rich man, poor man state. Because you have your South Beach, Miami, and then your backwoods.
Yeah, right. Then you have your Ronnie, Lonnie, and Donnie.
You have the guys that are fishing off a bridge, which has heavy traffic flow on it. Fishing for lunch off the bridge, or it's Tiger Woods' place or Shaquille's place on the waterfront.
40 mil.
Right. Yeah, there is a huge, I would say, arguably, Florida doesn't have a great, there's no state with a bigger swing. You know, West Virginia doesn't have the kind of range that Florida has. Never really thought about it. The thing about alligators and most reptiles is, it's funny, they don't have variable speeds. They don't have, like, medium, slow, sort of fast. They have on and off.
Yeah.
They're either dormant, they're just floating. Hey, is that thing alive? I don't know. Go poke it. Or 1,000 miles an hour and on top of your head. They don't really have, there's no jog. There's no equivalent to jogging in the reptile world. I think that's what's tough about alligators. They seem to be floating there just like logs. You think, is that real? Sometimes you see a reptile or an alligator, you go, is that thing even alive or is it made out of fiberglass? And then it's on. It's on top of your head. You're inside of the alligator. But no variable speed, no in between, you know? Me, I just hover around the middle. Never off, never really on.
They're fast on the ground. Fast on the ground. They've escalated.
They can outrun a horse. They always say that about every animal. Grizzly bears, snakes.
When I was growing up, the alligators you always heard about were eating people's dogs. It's like coyotes in California. Mm-hmm. And so I think alligators had a meeting, and they've escalated.
Well, that's my theory, which is they had a meeting, and every year they have it in Florida, because they're not rangy. And that must have gone something like this, because I was thinking, like, for 50 million years, nobody effed with us. 50 million years of being unmolested, the kings of the swamp. Everyone, you know, all you'd have to do is slide up on the side of the shore and everyone would just scatter. That's it. And now, in the last 3 years, every Yahoo in khaki shorts is diving on us and attempting to roll us and wrestle us and duct tape us together and all this stuff. Now they're fighting back. But they have to be confused. Like, essentially, 50 million years of unmolested, unchanged biology scaring every native that comes near the water. And the last 3 years, specials on Discovery Channel and every Yahoo in the world just dropping out of a tree and jumping on us. They have to be confused. It must be weird for them. And now what they're doing is they're reclaiming. They're saying, look, we're going to have to eat a couple of broads in order to get our street cred back.
But don't you think it's strange that they've eaten three models who are jogging?
It is suspicious.
Well, it sort of stands to reason. Wouldn't a nice looking woman taste better than, say, like a Brusca over here to your right?
I don't know. No. I think they'd probably want to go for, like, you know, a big person.
I'm chubby or I'm a lesbian.
See, all the three women they've eaten have been attractive, right? Yeah, and young.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And apparently the first gator stalked the woman.
What do you mean stalked?
So what is that? Like he was waiting out at her house?
Just calling her up and hanging up the phone?
I don't know. I saw a headline that said alligator stalked woman before eating her.
It's funny when they know the one, now they're going to go after and go get the one. I mean, there's 700,000 alligators in Florida, and they're going to go get the one that killed the broad. Do you think he's wearing her panties or something? Like, but how do they know which one did it?
Because it was in Miami.
Ooh.
It's not like she was jogging in the swamp.
Trendy, I mean, upstairs club.
Yeah, she, right. Yeah, it was at
the third floor of a Cuban restaurant.
Some club P. Diddy owns. And he was hanging out in the VIP lounge. He saw this girl.
Don't dance with me, huh? I'll show you.
You want to play a little hypothetical question with us, by the way, Alan?
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm.
He says nervously.
Mm. Yeah, this is good. This is good times. All right, Brisket, we got to take a break?
Yeah, just ask
him. I'll ask one, and then we'll take a break. You can think about it during the break. We'll come back and finish it off. These are people that you'd have to drive cross-country with. You got to drive from L.A. to New York with these people. Now, I'm not going to say specific. It's not Paris Hilton. It's this guy. You know, the guy who does this, the guy who does that. Here it is. Here are your two choices. We'll go to break. Don't answer. You have to drive cross-country with one of these two. Either it's the guy who gets up and swims every morning and explains to you how much he swims, how healthy it is, how invigorating it is. You know, when you're wiping the snot out of your eye and you're on your fifth cup of coffee to try to bring yourself back to life, and he's explained he already swam 3 miles at the Y, and when he gets out of the pool, he feels fantastic. The a-hole who swims laps at 5:30 every morning and won't stop telling you about it, or he essentially shames you because that was your morning. And then you had a couple of Tylenol, a croissant, some coffee, and you pleasured yourself. He went down to the wine, swam 4,000 laps. Okay, that guy or strip club DJ, heavy set, ponytail, leather fanny pack, maybe wearing the muscle shirt. He's the guy with the big arms but also has a big gut, and you're not sure whether to call him fat or not because he might be able to kick your ass. Has a double chin, but hides it well because he has facial hair that sort of essentially is like taking a Sharpie and drawing a line in. You know, you draw a picture of a guy's face, you just draw a circle, it looks like a fat face. But if you take a Sharpie and you start drawing lines in, all of a sudden, he has some bones, you know? That guy. It's either one of those guys. Don't answer, Alan.
All right.
Alan Covert here from Grandma's Boy. Out on DVD. We'll take a quick break. We'll be back with the answer to our hypothetical question and many more after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show, where everyone is entitled to Adam's opinion.
Kathy Griffin, can we do a little free association with
you
here?
Yes, I love it.
Charlie Sheen.
Wouldn't you be afraid to even be in the same room with him without wearing a hazmat? Like, he's got to be carrying viruses, exotic strains.
Feel like a 30-pound crab could leap from his groin and wrestle you to the ground.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of the Adam Carolla Show. Someone's going to win front row tickets to the new Cars and Blondie Saturday night at Gibson Amp and a Gibson SG Special electric guitar.
To me, it doesn't matter whether you play the middle riff, the end riff, the beginning riff. We'll either dig it or we won't. Just rock and we'll take you in. Do you play the guitar?
No.
We got another axe to grind this morning on the Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. Axe to grind, I get it. Alan Covert in studio. Grandma's Boy. Adam Sandler's best friend. You guys went to NYU together?
Yeah. And a couple other guys that work with us. Tim Herlihy, who writes all the movies, and Frank Caracci, who did Wedding Singer and Waterboy, and he just directed Click.
Oh, see,
well, we're afraid of new people.
Well, it's the devil, you know. Yeah. You know.
And, plus, your friend you can just yell at and humiliate, and 5 seconds later you go get a sandwich and everything's cool.
And you used to give Sandler food? You used to work at a restaurant and help him out?
Yeah, when we were at NYU, I managed, I was the night manager of a little Italian restaurant, and I used to give them all free food.
It's like that guy who picked up Howard Hughes along the road on the way to Nevada many years ago. Smart. He didn't know who the old bearded guy was at the time, but he's sure smart. He pulled over. You didn't know from Adam Sandler back in the day, but you toss him a little cannellini, right?
He was always funny, though.
Yeah, right. But I had friends that were funny, too, and they're swinging a hammer now. Wow. So Sandler crapped out a kid, therefore you must crap out a child, and everyone in the group must crap out a child.
Well, actually, our other partner, Jack, he had a kid 3 weeks ago. So he was first.
Sandler commanded he have a child first.
He said, you have it first so I can see what it's going to be like. Then he had his a couple
By
years
By the way, the Sandler baby name not released to the press.
It hasn't been?
No, last I heard. Are you allowed to say?
I didn't know it wasn't released to the press. I was going to say.
Why did you say anything?
See, you could have got it, but.
Well, it's not released to the press.
Yeah, it's not like Sandler.
That's not how I use my sources. I don't trick them.
Thank you.
All right.
Sandler's pretty private. I mean, you know. He put up a thing on this website that said, I had a kid, kid's healthy, wife's healthy,
I'm still
a moron.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's
end of story.
He's a regular guy.
Yeah, he doesn't care. He just wants to work and
so
go home.
So he wouldn't care if you told us the kid's
right.
name.
Right. What does he care? Regular guy. Regular guys tell you their kids' names.
Is it Jesus or Mohammed?
Adolfo.
It's Adolfo.
Oh.
It's Adolfo.
It's a girl.
Yeah, Adolfo.
Is it a normal name?
Yeah, it's a normal name. It's a normal name. I really had no idea. Otherwise,
well,
I just don't want to get yelled at by Adam's manager.
I know, but I'll tell you what.
What are you doing on the radio? That's exactly the call I would get at 8:02. What was that?
All right. Well, you don't have to tell us, but I'll tell you this. Just wink when we get it. We'll keep going through girls' names until you wink. Sheila.
Amy.
No. Annie.
Susan?
Mary. No.
Abby?
No.
Stacy?
Are you sure
Tina?
No one said this name out on the public? I just don't want to be the first.
Lindsay?
Maggie?
I know Sandler wouldn't
Audrey.
Care, like I said.
He wouldn't. We'll prove it. Tough guy.
Nancy?
Sadie.
Sadie?
Oh, that's cute.
I like that
I
name.
Knew it.
I was right this close.
Yeah. That was
that's an
be
adorable
my name.
But I know I saw it somewhere else. That's why I said
that. That is a cute name.
That's
Alan
adorable.
Covert here. He does Adam Sandler's bidding. He also is in a movie called Grandma's Boy, out on DVD, unrated.
But
and
see,
boobies abound.
Oh, yeah. I did Adam Sandler's bidding. Then I got to do my own movie.
That's how it works. I got to do some bidding.
They threw me a bone after all that bidding.
We were playing a hypothetical question. This is who do you drive cross country with? Which guy? The guy swims 500 laps every morning at the Y at 5 a.m. and never stops telling you about how invigorating it is and how refreshed he feels and ready to attack the day. That guy or the strip club DJ? Leather fanny pack, wearing, ooh. He's wearing the workout guy pants.
Okay.
Hey, everybody. It's all of Cryer's Randy, State Street. Great and draft your leading voice. Boy, show me appreciate with it. Blah, 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 blah. Sherry, stage one. Blah, 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 blah. I like when they do a little bit of air traffic controlling in between the, you know, carnival barking that they do. Everyone, there's official business to take care of.
Oh, they got
to
tell the girls which stage to go
right,
to.
Right, how would you know? Right. You don't want two girls on stage three.
There should be. Can't they get the ladies' pagers or something? Because there's nothing worse than, hi, fellas. Tell you, I got a businessman's lunch coming up this Tuesday. Jugs of Plenty is going to be performing. Jade, stage five. Jade. Can we automate this guy? We've replaced every other worker in America with a machine. Can't we just get some sort of automated strip club DJ so we don't have to hear this fat guy yapping? Oh, and that guy gets laid way more than we ever did.
Well,
that's the saddest part.
As a point of information to clarify, since I've never been to a strip club, does this guy, who Alan may have to take the road trip with, does he also do bits?
No, he does. Ooh. He thinks he's funny. He thinks he's funny. Now, here's the tough part, too. If he sees me and Kimmel come walking in, he'll up his game a little bit because he's the man show, guys.
Hey, I'll tell you what, quit your grin and drop you in some ghosts of blow. Tell you what, Sherry, stage one, Sherry. Hey, man, show, everyone, the big Ziggy Socky over here. Jimmy Kimmel entering the champagne room, everybody. Tell his wife, you see her on the street, I mean, ex-wife. Change, four, okay. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, once in a while you get sucked into their vortex. It's tough, and I'm sure Sandler and Adam Sandler and Alan come walking in a club, you're going to get the same.
That never happened.
You never been to a strip
never
club
been
with
to a
Sandler?
Strip club. Sandler and I have never seen naked.
No. You're either not friends or gay partners. It's one or the other.
Our wives are listening to the show right now.
Oh.
Are you allowed to say the name of your wife on the radio? Or did Adam forbid that?
Wow. No, Catherine.
So, where were we? Yeah, strip club DJ.
I'm going with Swimmer.
Swimmer.
Yeah. DJ.
Sorry.
No, that's no, wrong. No. Here's why, though. DJ's
got a joint on him, at least.
Good point. But he's also probably got crystal meth, and so we're going to go to jail. He's going to probably smell a little.
Yes. He will smell.
More than likely a lot. And you're going to think, now, if it was hang out with him at his strip club, I'm taking him.
Right.
But it's not like he has a free pass to every strip club along the way.
Well, that's a good point, right. But I would argue.
But also, Swimmer, you can just punch in the face and tell to shut up.
What's
he going to do?
Well, I will.
He's
a
swimmer.
He's got good wind from the swimming.
That doesn't matter. He'll need it when I'm choking him.
There are no wrong answers on hypothetical question, but I will say this. Gas prices, all-time high. Strip club DJ weighs at least 130 pounds more than the guy who swims every day. From here to New York, that could translate into thousands of dollars as far as gas goes.
Plus, I like the smell of chlorine.
Yeah, it does. It smells good. I like when the guy's eyelashes start getting bleached out. When your eyelashes turn blonde, you spend too much goddamn time in the pool. All right, next one. You ready?
Oh, I got another one?
We got another one.
Oh, man.
This is sales guy. Okay. Sometimes these are low-grade politicians too, but sales guys do the same thing. They find out your name, and they use it over and over and over again, and they think they're sort of endearing themselves to you, but really it's a paper-thin kiss-ass move. So it's like, hello, what's your name?
Alan.
You know, Alan, I have children myself, Alan. I named them both Alan, the boy and three girls, all named Alan. You know, Alan, I share some of the same concerns that you have as a parent, Alan. Alan, when I started, when my family came to this country, Alan, my dad, Alan, my grandmother, Alan, my grandfather, Alan, on the boat, the SS Alan, you know, they just keep working out. They'll keep saying your name. It's one of those stupid sales and politicians
thing. It's a Dale Carnegie thing. Like somebody read that.
Repeat, look him in the eye and say his name 128 times.
And offer him an opportunity
that he can't refuse.
Alan, you don't seem to me like a stupid man. Alan, you recognize an opportunity when you see. I have a hedge fund named Alan. All right, so the guy uses the name over and over and over again, or the cop that stuffs in too many words when he's saying, okay, what I'm going to need you to do for me right now is go ahead and get your driver's license registration out for me, okay, right now? The guy just keeps going. This doesn't say license and registration. Okay, right now, what we need you to do for me, sir, what I'm going to ask you to do for me right now is to go ahead. He's the guy who says, go ahead. As if it's like Simon Says or Mother May I or something. If he said license and registration, but didn't say, go ahead and get your license and registration, you wouldn't know what to do. You'd be stymied. So what I need you to do for me right now, sir, is to go ahead and get for me your license and registration. Okay, right now? Okay, that guy versus the guy who uses your name too much.
Cop.
I'm sorry.
No. I have reasons.
Let's hear them.
The cop, hopefully you could get drunk and convinced to use his badge to pull over hot girls.
And he could flash his tin if you got pulled over.
Yeah,
along
if you got pulled
way.
Over, he gets you out of tickets. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he probably have some pretty cool stories to tell. Mm-hmm. The other guy.
Mm-hmm.
No, the other guy, about 30 minutes in, offers you $30 to take off your pants.
Right.
And, no. We're not going that way.
All right, last one.
Yeah.
I just thought of this one. Homeless black guy, homeless white guy. There's a difference. White guy's got the dog with the bandana on it and telling you stories about Vietnam. Black guy's crazy, but he's entertaining.
Yeah, I'm going homeless black guy.
Yeah,
you're right
on that one.
I used to work at the Santa Monica Improv. I used to be the doorman out front, so mm-hmm. I know my homeless categories and where I'm going.
Yeah, super skinny, crazy, but talks a mile a minute. Homeless black guy, always entertaining. Scares you every 8 or 10 miles, but you're fine.
Yeah, but then he pulls out like great books out of his shopping cart. Weird things.
Yeah, he's eclectic. All right, we need to take ourselves a break. Alan Covert, I want to thank you very much.
Hey, thank you.
For coming in. Grandma's Boy, the unrated DVD out in stores as we speak. Always a good time. Say hi to your buddy, Adam, for me.
I definitely will. Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure. We'll be right back with news and sports after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. Comedy, opinions, celebrities, news, sports, and so much more.
This is Tori Spelling. You're listening to the insert adjective here. Adam Carolla Show.
Oh, I get it.
The Adam Carolla Show.
Hey, this is Danny Bonaducci. Please call Adam Carolla at 1-866-901-ADAM. Ask him if he's got bail money.
Yes, indeed. Doug Hall, the judge, the inventor extraordinaire, is coming in here. I have some inventions to bounce off of him. There was some statistic I heard that each house in America has an average of 17 of his inventions. I don't know if it's his inventions, things he's worked on, things he's been involved with. I'm not saying it's the television set, maybe it's Saran Wrap, but the point is something like 17 items average in each American home that Doug Hall has been involved with the concept of.
He's a regular Ron Popeil.
It is, yeah. Maybe not quite as big a blowhard as Ronnie.
Well, we'll see.
Well, we'll see. Anyway, he's the judge on American Inventor. He'll come in here in just a couple of few. Deaf Rat Guy. One of my favorite inventions of recent past. Deaf Rat Guy and his potato gun will be
in
studio.
Some shocking news, apparently.
Really?
He's going to drop a bomb.
That's what I hear. I don't know.
I don't know what it is either, but he'll drop that bomb coming up soon. And also we have our Gibson guitar giveaway. You must rock out in the studio, and we'll give you $1,000 worth
of
Gibson
guitar.
Not to
mention, by the way, speaking of bombshells, apparently Fat Tad has an even bigger bombshell. That's the word on the street.
You don't know what it is.
I have no idea. All I know is that Brusca and Angie know what it is.
I also know what it is.
You do?
Yeah, I overheard it. It's big.
So Dave and I are the only two people in the building.
That don't know.
Along with Big Tad, who I guess forgot.
I'm guessing forgot.
Who don't know what's going on, but Big Tad will come in. And this is not just a bunch of radio talk. I have no idea what it is.
No, it's a major life event.
It's big. He'll come in and talk about that as well. All right. So, before all that, we'll do a little something called the news with Teresa Strasser.
Immigration continues to be the big story. Yesterday, the Senate backed construction of a 370-mile triple-layer fence along the Mexican border. The fence would cost roughly $3.2 million per mile, making it $900 million for the 300-mile fence.
I bet they'll do a good job on it.
Do you think they'll use immigrant labor?
Probably. They don't do great jobs on levees to save black people, but they do great jobs when they have to keep the brown man out of the country, the more you know. Wow, that is some powerful stuff right there.
By the way.
People always do a thing, too, where they go, hey, listen, that wall's not going to work. Wall never stopped anyone. Oh, yeah? How do prisons work, everybody?
Walls.
Yes, they take a group, they put a wall around it, nobody gets out or gets in. Well, that's the way it works. Walls
guards
actually work quite nicely. That's right.
In entertainment news, on American Idol last night, one of the three finalists had a very bad day. In fact, the voting was so close, the losing contestant was only 0.2% behind in the voting. Here is Ryan Seacrest.
Let's look at the lowest percentage. 33.06%. Who is so close to going on, but is going home tonight?
It's out of 150%, so it's not as close as it seems.
Let's see it now.
Seacrest, a football coach. What's 150% out of everybody?
Yeah, I mean,
I was flabbergasted. It was literally 33, 33, and 33.
It was he was 0.2 of a percentage point away from who I'm guessing was McPhee.
Yes, for those of you who aren't great at math, it's as if you just took three people, whacked up 100 evenly, and now you had one to divvy up to decide who the winner was going to be. Incredible. And the more incredible part is the part where I know if that happened to our own Dave Damashek, or myself, or anybody I went to high school with, Cousin Sal, any of these guys, and I got kicked off and had 33%, it'd be like, holy Jesus, effing mother, effing God, damn it, are you assing me? Are you assing me? Seacrest, let me grab my, are you got to be assing me? Are you telling me we shared the same whole number? It's a it's 100th of one, are you got to be, and then they'd hand me the mic, sing a song. Are you telling me there are four people in North America who didn't vote for? Are you got to be
count them then, again?
Jesus, mother, effing, goddamn, you, I, you. I'd just say it'd be 45 minutes of that. The place would clear out. I'd still be standing on stage going, I cannot. And then I'd be yelling at the audience, you are so goddamn lucky. You are. I can't believe that. That's all of it.
Do over. It's too close. Do over.
It's amazing. It's a person like, thanks, Ryan. And the hand of the mic's like, we caught in a trap. I can't walk. I'd just be like, oh, my God. No, listen, I'm not going to be right for a couple of months. I mean, I may not have a solid bowel movement for a week. Forget about singing.
He handled it with grace and dignity, oh. I must say. Dateline has an ongoing series about...
Let me say this. Please. I want to get back to this American Isles because it's something I've said many times. Yes. People don't know my own personal shame, pain and heartache from coming from North Hollywood, the Los Angeles area. Right. There's no local boy makes good. Sure, I'm literally a millionaire and a big star, but right. I'm from here. No one says anything. Now, they did the thing. I don't know if you saw it, Sheck, yes. Last night. I know you did, T. They did the thing where Elliot and Taylor went back to Virginia, Alabama, wherever they're from. Malls closed down. Literally in malls filled with 10,000 people holding up banners. Elliot, both of them. Keys to the city, meeting the governor, meeting the mayor. Ticker tape parade going down the main street with the high school band playing. I mean, every just sort of... everything you ever think of when they make a movie about local boy makes good from the 50s, that's what happened. Filling places, middle of the afternoon. Okay.
McPhee?
McPhee, who's from my town. She's from Sherman Oaks, which is a nice city, one city over from the crappy North Hollywood. Went to Notre Dame High School, where one of the Kimmel children goes, I do believe. Nothing. She does some morning radio. She then takes a helicopter ride and gets to look at the Hollywood sign. And she goes back to her high school where they had an assembly. That's the way it works. Hey, kids, it's noon. Yeah, go out to the basketball arena and clap for this chick who you don't care about. And then she's going to split. And it was uncomfortable when Seacrest talked to her about it. It was kind of weird. But that's the thing. When you're from Los Angeles, nobody cares. There's no such thing as a homecoming. There's no anything.
Right.
No ticker tape parade. There's nothing. They couldn't. She's the hottest chick. She has the best pipes. She's going to be a huge star. They couldn't get enough people together to fill the parking lot of a 7-Eleven for her.
Well, I think there are so many celebrities. I've been in Ralph's, literally, and Julia Roberts is behind me buying groceries. So it's hard to get excited about McPhee here.
I had Clooney in my cart last time I was at the supermarket.
He was in the cart.
Physically in the cart.
Okay, let's talk about perverts, shall we?
Yes.
Dateline has had an ongoing series where they do these online predator sting operations. I don't know if you've seen these.
Oh, yes, I have.
How could you miss them? They're amazing. On every night of the week.
I think they did it once and got an amazing rating, and now they can't stop doing them.
Yes, they're obsessed.
And yet, the predators have not caught on, and they keep setting up these fake dates. In the clip I'm about to play for you, there's a teenage actress playing the girl who set up the date. She lures a guy to a house where a very indignant reporter is waiting. Here's how it went down.
Did you bring protection?
Yeah.
Perfect.
The only bad news about that is you're probably not going to need that type of protection tonight.
Yeah, I knew this was going to be a setup.
You did?
Yeah.
How did you know that?
Just because of where she was talking online.
Brian, what's your last name?
I don't have a last name.
Doesn't have a last name.
Well, maybe he's a rapper. my point. And there's nothing better. There's a few things. First off, don't talk to people through doors who say, like, come on into the kitchen, take your pants off and have a Toll House cookie. I'll be out in a minute. Oh, yeah. That's all things. Like, I need to see some booby now or I'm not coming into the house. I'm not coming in and taking my pants off and eating a cookie in the kitchen waiting for you to come. And they're always like, the guys are always like, hey, come outside. Come outside. No, come on in. Come on in. It's weird. It's like no one says, look, sweetie, why can't you open the door? Come on in. They come in and Brian comes out there and he's carrying a clipboard. And that moment where people get busted, the pedophile there and here comes the guy. And oh, it's always it's crazy casual, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How's it going? And Brian Williams starting to say, hey, how you doing?
And for weird, some reason, they're always feeding him a cookie. And yes. Then he's like, I don't want your cookie.
The tough part is when he gets tackled by the cops on the lawn when he leaves. And I was really thinking about it. Cops are sort of like alligators in that they have two speeds, right. Either off and on, no medium speed. They take these guys down, and I feel bad for them because they're just walking out to the car, and eight cops bum rush. Good job. The guy's just standing there in sweatpants, and they pummel him and tackle him on the lawn.
It is the second wave of pain for them, too. They get embarrassed. They know they're right on TV talking to the reporter. They walk out the door. They say, whoo, that was embarrassing.
Yeah, and then
the eight fat cop bum rush tackle on the lawn. But here's the thing about with the cops. I don't know that these guys are dangerous to anyone other than the 13-year-olds they're trying to hump on. None of them are armed. It's not like they're walking wearing trench coats with their hands in their pockets. They're just wearing sweatpants and T-shirts, and they're walking back to their truck. How about I get down on the ground, and let's see if I do it without you tackling me down to the ground.
Give me a chance to do it the nice way.
That's all I'm saying. If there are any cops that are listening, if you have to bring the ace man down, give the verbal command. I will immediately drop. We can avoid the part where the eight of you bum rush me, and you put your knee in my spine.
In Philadelphia,
one guy brought his kid.
Yes, one guy brought his kid, no. And one guy had his sister give him a ride.
One guy had his sister waiting in the car. And by the way, file this under definitely not a Jew.
Right.
Waiting in the car with his nieces and nephews.
Yes.
Had like a 3 and 4 year old niece and nephew and his sister. They're just going to wait in the car. Hey, I got to take care of a little business. Got to make a quick house call. Car's on the fritz. You mind if you drop me? Hey, sis, mind if you drop me by the house? And the other guy walked in with his 4-year-old in tow.
Yeah.
Actually, just coming out with the kid.
Father of the year, not getting it this year around. Okay, in Philadelphia, a woman found out her husband had been cheating on her. After he fell asleep, she grabbed his penis and one testicle and pulled them both clean off. The husband was rushed to the hospital for reattachment surgery, and though he lost a lot of blood, he's currently in stable condition, according to a local news report.
How is that possible?
I have been thinking about this all day, but this is according to a local news report in Philly. She pulled, with her bare hand, pulled off the penis in one testicle.
Wow.
Marco.
She's facing assault charges, but I think it might get bumped up to attempted murder, just a guess.
What's the song there, Brian?
Detachable penis.
You know Detachable Penis?
You never heard this?
I did. I wanted to give him credit for it.
It's a good song. Nice job. Yeah, look, I say if your penis comes off with one tug, you have a flawed penis. Because I've been tugging at mine since the 9th grade, and it is still
not
intact. In fact, I think it's stronger.
If Fat Tad's bombshell is that he was the victim of this.
That will be awesome.
That'll be interesting. Okay, lastly, tonight, Will and Grace airs its final episode.
Oh.
I'm Teresa Strasser, and that's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
All I know is I hope that Fat Tad and Def Rat Guy's bombshells that apparently are coming up here later in the show, if they're painful, I don't think I can take it. My heart's already in a million pieces.
You're
over
fragile.
This cheat
over the Sharks thing.
The Sharks lost last night.
Well, you know, Dave on line one says he has a replacement name for Chi-Chu that could work for us in the playoffs.
Let's hear it, buddy.
Dave?
Yeah.
We're prepared to be disappointed, but go ahead.
Damashek, I think you're blowing it, you know? I don't think you've dug deep enough into the bag of tricks of an NHL name. I mean, I'll give you the Chi-Chu. And I'll give you Tamu, you know, but there's some others out there, you know. I'm not sure. I saw his name in the paper. I think it was arthroscopic surgery on his knee. Not sure what team, but Saku Koivu.
Oh, Saku Koivu.
Oh my God. Have you dropped the ball?
Rouge Blanc et Bleu.
Exactly.
Captain of the Canadians.
Well, where's he been all my life?
Koivu. He's been eliminated. Saku Koivu. Certainly, yes. That's a good.
I think there might even be a song in there. Saku Koivu, right? You could bust that.
Yeah, except for, they didn't make the playoffs, but still, you could have brought him up.
Yeah.
Here's your other guy. Not sure if he's in the league anymore. He used to actually have a hockey card on this guy. Carolla, you'd appreciate this guy. His name, Yerky Lume. I'm sure you pulled a couple.
You remember Yerky
Lume? Yeah.
Yerky 3-2-3 times a
Vancouver
day.
Vancouver Canucks, yes?
Yeah, that was it.
Wow.
At least one team he was on. I'm not
Nobody
sure
knows
was.
The puck like Damashek over here. Yes, thank you, Dave. I'm just cutting him off.
How about another one, a retired one? Reijo Ruotsalainen. The point is.
Reijo.
The point is this. Right. It's too soon for any of this kind of talk. Chi-Chi's out. My heart hurts, and that's that.
You don't get a new puppy the day after your dog dies.
Right.
Here's what I'm going to do. Tamu and I'm going to speak on his behalf. He and I are both going to press on, because, as I said, I think that's what Chi-Chi would want us to do.
Okay.
However, I did pen a song from the heart, and I'll get to that in a moment. First, though, I'm going to... Staples Center
tonight. If you don't think you can do
your
sports this morning.
I'm going to try. I'm going to do it for Chi-Chi. This one goes out to you, Johnny, wherever you are.
Well, I know he's a big fan.
Staples Center tonight. Game 6 between the Phoenix Suns and the L.A. Clippers. Suns lead at 3-2. Must win for the Clippers. 7:00 in the p.m. at the Staples Center tonight. Are they focused on the task at hand? Or are they giving in to distractions, sitting around, getting fat from all their success, watching TV? I went out and I asked them, you know, are they sitting around watching daytime
TV?
Talk
to the Clippers.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Let's hear what they said. Here's Sean Livingston, the nifty young guard. This is a tough one. Who is your favorite lady on The View?
Favorite lady on The View? Diane Sawyer.
Okay, so Sean Livingston's in the clear.
Right.
Diane Sawyer is not on The View, so that's all right. Here's Walter McCarty, though. This is a tough question. Who is your favorite lady on The View?
Wow.
A lot of nice choices to pick from.
Can't stand the young one. The quarterback's what, Hasselbeck, his wife? Mm-hmm. Can't stand her. I love the lady who sits next to her who's funny. She doesn't care what she says. She used to be a comedic or something?
Yeah, Joy Behar, right?
That's my favorite one, right?
It's incorrect. That was a trick question. The correct answer to that is, I've never seen the show.
Well, I'm married. So I have to watch it regardless.
I don't see anything funny about that. Fortunately, our pal Chris Kamen, the center, he came up with the correct thing. Who's your favorite lady on The View?
On the what?
On The View.
The morning show, right? Who's on there? Tell me the ladies.
You got the girl who's married to Hasselbeck, the quarterback. You got the lady, Joy Behar, the comedian.
I don't know any of those people.
Correct answer. Well done.
Smart.
There you go. Yes.
He's also the one guy in the Clippers, I believe, who knew what a Clipper was.
That's right.
So he's batting 1,000.
Yes, he is solid. Yeah. He is solid. Elsewhere in the NBA playoffs, Spurs pulled it out over the Mavericks barely last night. Eastern Conference was supposed to be a gimme for the Pistons, but all of a sudden they're on the brink of elimination at the hands of LeBron and his Cavalier pals. They won last night. That'll be very exciting if that happens. Pastime quickly. Dodgers, Padres, Athletics, Giants, your winners, your losers. Snakes.
Hold on, wait a second.
Those are the winners?
Dodgers won?
Dodgers won.
But that means they're not 500.
Correct.
Are you sure
they
didn't?
Game up. 21
oh, so
and
they'll
20.
Lose. Oh, they'll lose. Did they play today?
They do.
Okay, then they'll lose today. All right, that's fine. I thought I was confused because they weren't 500.
Creep. Putting down our national pastime. I don't get it.
162 games.
You're losers. Please. Snakes, Mariners,
by the way,
Halos.
If you're going to play 162 games, why stop? Why take the 3 weeks off when you actually stop playing? Just keep playing. Just keep going. Just keep going. That's all. It won't even be a season. You'll just keep playing.
You're hurting Dave, and he's already been through so
much.
Sorry, David.
I'd love to debate you on this, but my heart just isn't
in it. Sorry.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
As we just discussed, San Jose Sharks and their star, Jonathan Chichu, Went up to Edmonton last night, backs to the wall. By the way, the Canadian crowd, you know, the fans of Edmonton were there in San Jose. The Canadian national anthem was booed a few days ago, so everybody was anxious to see what the response of the Edmonton crowd would be. Here's what they did. Classy. They applauded the national anthem and then sang really loud the Canadian national anthem with great pride. It was cool.
Yeah,
that was
that's
cool.
That's a class act.
What was not cool was the 2-0 result. Edmonton Oilers advance to the finals to play Temu and the Ducks. It's all over, though. The dream is done. Goodbye, Choo-Choo.
Will I know your names? If they're not Chichu or Temu, will I watch the games without Chichu and Temu? I must be strong.
Sure, Clapton's delighted here.
Yeah, he wrote that about his dead son.
His song. Son who fell from the balcony of his condo.
It would be wrong without Chichu.
But I would answer my question this way. Does Clapton, does he know the pain of having a guy with a crazy name fall out of the NHL playoffs? I don't think so.
He doesn't know.
Here. Chichu, Godspeed.
Everyone deals with grief differently.
He'll be missed.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right, so what do we got to look forward to? Well, Def Rat Guy's going to come in here and drop a bomb. I know not what it is. Big Tad is coming in here and has a neutron bomb to drop.
It's big.
Damashek and I are the only two guys on the floor, evidently, who don't know what it is, but I don't care. I'll hear it when it comes out of the literal horse's mouth. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We'll be right back with Doug Hall, judge from American Inventor. He's a genius. I have legitimate inventions to pitch to him.
Oh, good.
And I want to hear his honest critique of them after this. Parting gift
that cannot be. The Adam Carolla Show. This is what a year and a half of junior college sounds like.
Hi, this is Jessie Jane, and every time I get invited to come to the Adam Carolla Show, I end up taking off my clothes. I mean, I have opinions on stuff.
AdamCarolla.com. It's so much better than internet porn. The Adam Carolla Show.
Oh, I got more ideas for you. How about I got a gay beverage here, like a sort of Gatorade, but for the gays. How about this? A helmet brake light for motorcycles. My invention, the heated sofa. You need a cat skinner. A microwave that'll handle foil. The toilet timer. Oh, wow. I forgot about my Gatorade. You know, they lose nutrients that straight people just don't. Whatever activities they do.
I like how your ADD keeps you from remembering your own good ideas. So now that you hear them again, you're like, wow, I like that one.
Nobody loves his own ideas regurgitated back to him more than the Ace Man's been said many times. Doug Hall is here from American Inventor. The finale, by the way, is tonight, 8 p.m. on ABC. And then 9 p.m., the results show. Welcome to the show, by the way, Doug.
Thanks for having me.
You're very dynamic on the show, I must say.
Well, I have some fun. I have a lot of fun. I mean, you know, when it comes to inventing, there's a fine line between genius and stupidity.
Right.
And on the show, we get to walk down that line and see both sides.
And you're
more stupidity sometimes than genius.
And you're tough. You give a lot of tough love, but I think you're just trying to be realistic with the contestants.
I just tell the truth. That's all I do.
And you're in Mensa, so you know the truth.
That's right.
Doug... Was I right when I said earlier that there's something like 17 inventions that you've been either directly or indirectly responsible for in the average American home?
Yeah, it's actually 18. There's 18 products 18. In the average home that I've done. But when you figure that we work with Procter & Gamble, Nike, Walt Disney, Ford,
you know,
Gatorade, you know, and all these companies.
Gatorade?
No, it wasn't that one that I worked on.
Is there any potential to that?
Well... Yeah, there is potential in everything.
Well, yeah. I mean,
there's always potential.
How about it? Because there's, you know, there's FUBU. This is gay boo. You know, I mean, this is for them by me or however it works. Right. But the point is I've always said this. Here's how I know we'll buy anything. They have volleyball, indoor volleyball shoes, and they have basketball shoes, and they're both played on the same court. You know what I mean? Seems to me that a pair of high-top Nikes would work just as good if you're playing volleyball as volleyball shoes would, but yet there's a market for volleyball shoes.
But you got to remember, though, that just because you see it doesn't mean it's profitable. And in fact, mm-hmm. we know now that 95% of the products introduced by companies fail. You actually have better odds at a Vegas slot machine than most companies have with their new products.
Really?
So just because in their mind it's an idea doesn't mean it's really going to succeed.
Well, I just think Gatorade. Think of we focus. We have we have different ones. We have the sports drink. We have the sort of me day cocktail, pina colada, that kind of stuff. And if we gear it, it's for you guys.
You know, I got to tell you, you know, clearly there's something here that's different because we just did a session for them, inventing new ideas for new products for
the
next
gays?
Summer. For Gatorade.
Gatorade, right.
Gatorade, yeah, right. Yes. Mm-hmm. And we just did that, and that idea never came up. So. Mm. You know, I don't know why it didn't come up. Actually, I do know why. But
it would be offensive, but I still think it would probably work. The gays have a sense of humor. And they start mixing that with a little Patron or something. The next thing you know, you got a party.
Actually, Gatorade is an incredible mixer.
Yeah.
Really? It really is. It's a phenomenal mixer.
Yeah, it's good because when you booze, you lose the fluids, the electrolytes,
That
kind of stuff. And Dr. Drew would always say, if you're dehydrated the next morning or whatever, chug some Gatorade or Pedialyte or something like that. That, oh, by the way, that's how you know a guy parties, when he buys the Pedialyte baby formula and has no children. That is the sign of a guy I want to hang out with. All right, so what inventions have you been responsible for? In a not in a less roundabout way, in a more direct way.
We do stuff for the companies, and the way we work is we get $150,000 for 2.5 days.
Wow!
So it's a good business, but the deal is we have to keep it secret because they like to take credit. Although,
Stuff that has come out that you can
even
talk about.
Even when it comes out, they don't like us to do it. But I was on Dateline NBC with Pepsi, and they talked about two things. One was good. One wasn't so good. One was the very first ready to drink tea, Lipton Original before Snapple, giant tea bag. Goes into a pot.
Yeah,
that's literally how
I've
we
used
make
that.
It.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. That one worked out great. The other one, well, Crystal Pepsi. It didn't quite make it.
Didn't fly.
You win some, you lose some.
So you're saying Nike wants people, the public, to believe that Michael Jordan is hard at work in his basement designing the next shoe, not you, not the short, bald, white guy who's sitting at your ranch crunching numbers with your other white, short friends.
Well, we have some non-white friends, too. You know.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we do. Yeah,
sure, they got the affirmative action.
Yeah, even in Ohio, we do. That's right. They like to take all the credit.
Right, okay.
Well, like a ghost inventor.
Can I float a couple of my ideas and you now, tell me what you think,
do you
potentially?
Want the truth, or do you want me to suck up to you?
I want both.
I'll do the first.
I want the truth.
Okay.
But I don't want you to poo-poo them just because they're coming from the mouth of a comedian with a Brillo hat.
But on the other hand, though,
yes,
Ace, you don't like to be patronized either.
Right.
That's a great idea, Adam.
I don't want that either. Seriously, here's some of the ones we talked about in when we bumped in. But how about a microwave that takes foil? This isn't my invention, but it seems to me that most things you take home, you go to the Italian joint,
Chinese.
You take home the food, the Chinese has the little metal handle on the thing. You can't pop it into the microwave. You have to scrape the congealed goodness of the, you know, spaghetti and meatballs onto a plate and then put that in a microwave. How about a microwave you could put foil into or metallic items
into?
The
reality is you can put metal into the microwave as long as it's not touching the edges.
But it does seem to spark and make a mess.
If it's touching. But the reality is the problem is it's going to be a barrier. So, I mean, that's called a convection oven is what that would be.
Right. So
it already exists.
But
it's called a convection oven.
Right, it blows.
Yeah.
I heard you. Don't get angry.
Lecturing
but you're
you.
Not seeming to listen.
I invented something.
It's over.
Listen,
okay,
I invented something called the door. You want me to show it to you? I'll show you my new invention. It's called the door.
How does it work?
Good day.
All right.
You know, in today's world, we can't waste time
this
on these
is not
things.
Going
you know,
well.
We're going to get killed by the
All
people
right, let's
from other
keep,
countries.
Let's keep going. How about this one? I'm serious about it. How about a mattress with a hole in it? Now, let me explain. I sleep on my stomach. Most guys will sport some form of wood throughout the night. I would say 70% of males, or at least 50% plus, sleep on their bellies. You get the wood, it's like shoving a bottle jack under a van, you know? It's tough. Other thing is I now have to get up and urinate once or twice an evening, too. If I could take my phallus and drop it through the hole in this mattress, and if I felt like going, I just go right into my gutter system. A mattress with a hole in it would probably be more comfortable. Ha! Here's what I'm going to say. The bike seat. Remember the bike seat. The bike seat did not change. A 10-speed bike seat didn't change for 100 years. Then about 10 years ago, they started putting a trough in the middle of it, realizing, okay, might as well make a space for the guy's junk to rest. We'll make a trunk for the junk to rest in the seat. And it took off like wildfire. How about my mattress with the hole in it?
Help me understand. How are you going to make sure you keep your aim right? Because if you miss a little bit,
I'll have the hole big enough to drop the junk in. I'll put some sort of pull-out liner or something in it. I don't know, bedpan,
or maybe
a trough.
Something that attaches solid so you can't roll around.
Well, you don't have to.
You right down there.
Okay, now I'm going to show you my other invention called the elevator. You keep going. Point is, it'd be more comfortable to sleep that way, sleep on your belly, the junk down there, wouldn't it?
Well, I mean, I do think the idea of being able to go to the bathroom and not getting up, I mean, there's a benefit to that.
How many male Americans over the age of 45 are getting up nightly to make a trip to the bathroom?
You know, I bet
millions.
There will be a solution to being able to go to the bathroom in bed. With baby boomers there,
really?
I think that is the sort of bizarre thing.
There are millions of men that do this on a nightly basis.
And baby boomers are totally changing the world. Mm. I think that's probably on the leading edge, probably not there now. But I could see it happening.
Mattress with the hole in it. And
the bathroom thing. All right. The whole thing doesn't work for me.
I say this, too. If you have to yak in the middle of the night, too, no longer do you have to make it to the bathroom or potted plant. You go right into the... go right in there. All right, the other...
the old bedpan.
How about this one? How about... here's one. And I actually checked into this, but I've never seen it. A helmet brake light for motorcyclists.
You know, on American Inventor, we had a guy came on. Mm-hmm. With a light. And he had a helmet. Mm-hmm. And the idea was he had a little pen light that you could attach to it, mm-hmm. so that people could see in the back and the front, you know, just like they did with cars with that third light in the back.
Right.
And I asked him, I said, how much did it take to do this? He said, the light was cheap. It was only like a buck and a half. I said, congratulations. You've just taught all of America how to make one of those.
Right. Oh. Right. But it was not a brake light. It was a constant light.
Yes.
Here's my pitch.
That's a split hair.
It is not. I will make a pitch for this. In 19, I think it was like 86, they made it a DOT, Department of Transportation, made it a federal law that all cars had to have a third brake light in the center and up above, at least 3 feet off the ground or whatever the hell it was, depending on your car. And it cut down rear-end collisions like 65%. It was dramatic. People stopped ramming into each other when they saw this third light up high. Now, when you're riding a motorcycle, you only have one light. It's down low. A lot of people driving SUVs, four-wheel drives up high. You take this light, you put it in the back of the helmet. Eventually, it gets incorporated into the motorcycle and the helmet manufacturers. Bell, Shoei, whoever else makes helmets starts incorporating them into the design of the helmet. For now, you stick it on. You got one of those little lithium, cadmium, whatever batteries in there. You attach it to the brake light system on the motorcycle. Same kind of thing you use when you use a garage door opener, a little clicker thing. And it goes on when you apply the brake. And we give it to all the cops, all the highway patrolmen. It becomes a huge safety thing throughout the country. Every municipality who has a police motorcycle department has one of these things. How say you?
To make big volume on it, I'd make it a retrofit kit.
Mm-hmm.
You could make it wireless. Make it so that it attaches on the back of the helmet.
Mm-hmm.
Just have a thing that just snips on to the brake light line that's going back there.
Right.
And you could make it easily.
We're done. Let's get out of here. Let's blow this taco stand, Doug. Seriously.
That's a great idea.
I don't need the grief anymore.
You like the idea. It's
a great idea. The key is you got to get it bright enough. Mm-hmm. And you got to make it as a retrofit kit, because if you wait for the helmet guys to get organized with the bike guys, it's like hot dogs and rolls. You got 10 of these and 8 of these. Nobody gets together.
It starts as a retrofit kit. Eventually, it's a law. You can't sell a helmet that does not have this brake, because you get rear-ended in a motorcycle, you're dead meat. Wow. I think we should take a break. Are we running late, Brisket?
Yeah, we got to go get that frat guy next.
Oh, no. Can I say that? I like Doug too much.
One more pitch.
All right. One more pitch. Yes, go ahead.
I just wanted to point out, apropos of nothing that's being discussed here, though, that ever since your show hit the air, I've been obsessed with this. I cannot be the first one to bring up how much you look like the bad guy in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Yes? Everyone says this. Am I right? Look at this, Ace.
That's frightening.
I just assumed they're the same guy.
Identical, yes? You even laugh exactly like the guy.
Well, they're both silly maniacal.
Silly Americans always overdressing for the wrong occasion.
Well, it's really fun this week because we give the million away.
Oh, yeah.
And at 8 o'clock, they do the review of the show from last week, and then at 9 o'clock they've got the awards. And of course they stretch it out for a whole hour before you right. get to it. But there's some cool stuff. It's a cool show.
Tonight,
cool
show. 8 p.m. on ABC, and then the finale show where they give it away is following that at 9 o'clock. All right, last pitch. Very simple, yet have not seen this. Heating oil through the roof, right?
Yep.
I mean, heating oil prices, fuel prices through the roof. I think most Americans, going to give you the pitch before I give you the invention. Most Americans, if they're like me, once they get home from work, they have dinner and then they settle in on the sofa. Some even eat dinner on the sofa and they watch American Inventor and what else on the wonderful invention known as TiVo. They spend the lion's share of their time on the sofa. Meanwhile, it's cold outside. They have the heater on and they're heating the entire house. You're heating the living room. You're heating the dining room. You may not even set foot in that room. Your ass is on the sofa. How about a heated sofa? How about when you buy a sofa, and many sofas are ordered to take 6 weeks to come in, how about the option of a heating element in the sofa, saving millions of barrels of heating oil and coal every year, heating just your ass? And as a matter of fact, it would feel good if the rest of the house was cold when you got up off your heated sofa to walk into the kitchen.
So you're doing this to save oil?
Yes.
That's the reason.
Oh, I'd like to make money.
I think I see where Doug's going.
So it's to save money. Well, the answer is no.
No.
And why is that?
Because the energy transfer to do electric current through that couch,
right?
The energy there is far less efficient. The BTUs you're going to get from that barrel of oil will be far less than the BTUs you get out of the home heating system.
I disagree. Depends. You know, we don't know what size.
Well, what do you want to put on it? You want to do the math?
We don't know. Well, first off,
come on. I mean,
what size house? What size house are we talking about?
Well, but we can zone off the house. That's fine.
Well, but the reality is, do you think the majority of houses have zone heating?
Okay. How much thermodynamics did you take in college?
I know about British thermal units, and if you want to talk R value and insulation, keep going, pops. Yes, that's right.
The fact of the matter is that the energy use that it would be there. I mean, I can see it as a comfort thing for people. Have,
yes,
but the energy efficiency of electric strips kind of right. system would be really, really bad.
Well, a lot of houses use electricity to heat anyway.
Yeah, they have heated floors in houses. They have heated car seats.
You're saying a heated blanket essentially burns more fuel, burns more electricity than heating a home.
Per unit of heat that you get out, yes.
Well, it may not be as efficient, but still, bottom line is you would save money if you just heated your ass and not the entire house. Thank you.
If you turned the whole house off,
the more you know.
No, that's what I'm saying. You'd have frozen pipes, but that's okay.
All right.
So a few other consequences.
All right. Well, listen, I think you met your match, Doug. That's all.
say real quick. Say in a German accent. Say Schutzem. Schutzem both.
Schutzem both.
Nice.
Traveled back to Raiders times.
Doug Hall, everyone, American inventor, on tonight, 8 o'clock ABC. A fantastic show. A genius who begrudgingly, I think, recognizes my genius as well. But it takes one to know it.
You're worthy.
Seriously, let's go work on this helmet light and blow this fish stand.
Really, huh? I like that. The real idea that solves a real problem. And that's the key with an invention. It has to solve a real problem.
Doug, thanks for coming in. We'll hopefully see you soon, American Inventor, tonight. And we'll be right back with Def Rat Guy after this.
You're listening to the new Adam Carolla Show.
This is Dave Attell. Give Adam a call now at 1-866-901-ADAM. And some flunky intern's going to pick up the phone and put you on hold. And you'll have to listen to probably Air Supply. It's worth it.
If you're going to wake up with a strange hairy man, it might as well be him. The Adam Carolla Show.
If you're not wasted,
Maverick,
the day is, hell yeah.
Can't hear much, but he can still drink beer and party every day.
Well, he likes chicks, sorority girls are always ready to play.
Hell yeah.
Well, Moose gets Woody at the drop of a hat, but he says that he ain't bi. Just a fifth year senior living it up. Hearing loss ain't a crime. He's a deaf rat guy.
Maverick.
Deaf rat guy.
Hell yeah.
Deaf rat guy.
Maverick.
Deaf rat guy.
Deaf rat guy in studio. Name is Jason. He goes by Maverick. He's a teak over at USC, 50-year senior communications major. He's got a bomb to drop on us this morning.
Can't wait.
Welcome to the show, man.
Hell yeah.
Uh-oh. Sound a little bummed out.
He looks kind of intense, too.
Yeah. What happened?
I don't know how to say this, so I'm just going to say it.
Mm-hmm.
I was deactivated.
Deactivated from the teak house? What the?
It went all the way to the national.
Oh, really?
The powers that be have decided it would be in my own best interest.
Oh, no.
In the best interest of the national that I no longer remain in the house.
Oh, my God.
Effectively deactivating me.
So they're throwing you out of the teak house.
That's a shame, but on the other hand, you're about to graduate, so what's the difference?
No, first, you're wrong.
Uh-oh.
First of all, I'm not going to graduate. I am going to do a 6 year.
Oh, no.
Right. I've decided to do a 6 year.
Well, you've decided, but really what happened is they decided not to graduate you, so you decided to do a 6 year.
That is neither here nor there.
Oh, no.
What matters is I have decided to start my own fraternity.
Oh, really? You're going to start your own frat house.
Can you do that?
I don't even know how that works.
Hell yeah.
So, you've been thrown out of the teak house. You're going on for a sixth year.
Dude, you can't even say that.
Okay, I can't mention teak. You got to cease and desist with that?
Why did they kick you out?
There are many levels, and you can hear their version, or you can hear the truth.
Oh,
let's hear the truth.
I'd like to hear their version. All right, let's hear the truth, yeah.
They said that I was reflecting poorly on the house.
Well,
this came down. Look.
Right.
If you don't know anything about fraternity life, you have to understand something. These decisions are made by the powers that be behind drawn curtains in smoke-filled rooms.
This is not guys like Poochie, Mike F., and Moose. Not the salt of the earth frat boy. These guys wouldn't throw you out of the teak house.
No. These are lawyers, executives, and industry times.
Right. Wow. Former teaks. Alumni.
These are alums, I see.
Allegedly, there's no such thing as a former teak.
Okay. Right, you're
in for life, except me. They have exercised their right to deactivate me.
Wow.
That's so sad.
Wow.
Is it also a factor that you're coming back for your sixth year?
Yeah, is there an academic factor here?
So they said that my academic grade point average reflected poorly on the house.
Well,
but with this new fraternity I'm starting,
right,
that crap won't matter.
Right, you're not going to look at grades, you're going to look at character.
This was supposed to be about having a good time.
Right, a lot of guys hanging out, funneling brews.
Let me explain.
Mm-hmm.
The fraternity has a new herald and a coat of arms that I spent a long time.
So this is your new frat house.
Oh, that's why you handed me this deaffratguy.com.
Oh, he has a website.
That's where you would see something about this.
If you wanted to join up the fraternity, you might go to deaffratguy.com.
Hell yeah.
So this is sort of like you saw that movie Old School, starting your own fraternity then.
Dude, that movie was BS.
What?
That's not what it's really like.
Not a real reflection of frat living, huh?
I saw Will Ferrell on campus, and we made eye contact.
Okay, I thought there was an ending. Delta Fu Gamma.
That's the name?
That's the one, because all the other ones were taken, but Delta Fu Gamma has a cool ring to it.
Yeah, I don't know if Fu is a Greek letter.
The other Greek letters basically were taken.
So you had to make your own.
So it's DFG.
Oh, Defreka.
Right.
The Delta Foos.
Right, Delta Foos. All right.
And on your website, I noticed it looks like you're the only member so far.
There's three pictures of you.
Bro.
She's most, a chick, by the way.
You can most, call me bro.
Right.
Most will join Smitty.
Poochie?
Uh-huh. Mike. Poochie is playing golf in Hawaii with his uncle right now.
What but a life.
Of course he'll join.
You sure Mike F. and Poochie are on board?
Mike F., help me write the charter.
Okay, all right.
Now, wait
don't
a second.
Get angry
so
at me.
Moose and everybody, they're just ditching the Teaks to follow you, to your new friend.
They've given a verbal commitment.
Oh. I see. And you trust that.
Let me explain the coat of arms. There are two items in the herald. The beer funnel,
right.
which represents joy.
Yeah, I'm looking.
Joy.
And the potato gun, which represents strength.
So strength and joy, where they intersect, that's what...
That's what we are all about.
Delta Foo Gamma.
Flanking the herald is a jackrabbit, which represents virility, productivity, and getting down.
Right. Yeah, humping like down a rabbit, right?
Is this a co-ed fraternity?
You know what? I think we have to get members, but no, uh-huh. But there's one rule.
Uh-huh.
No fat chick.
Well, what's on the other side flanking
yeah,
the...
Yeah, I see the jackrabbit on the right side of the coat of arms.
On the other side, representing wisdom, is the owl. Now, you will notice that it's vomiting bile.
It's vomiting owl, yes.
It's vomiting green bile, which represents... The bitterness and sourness of the schism.
I see, between you and the Teaks.
But also, puking bile represents purity and a new start.
Right.
Right.
The wisdom of the owl vomiting. Tony, it's a purging of sorts. Tony?
Yes, sir?
Tony, you'd like to join the Delta Foo Gamma house?
Yeah, hell yeah, I sure do. That's just so... So
there's a guy on the phone saying he wants
out.
To join.
How are they going to kick him out? How are they going to kick out Death Frat Guy? That's the most important person in the fraternity.
I don't...
If it wasn't for Death Frat Guy, they wouldn't even know who the fraternity was.
Yes. I don't know. It'd be like the Steelers cutting Big Ben.
Right.
It just doesn't make sense. Yeah, he is the quarterback of the Teaks. He's the team captain. How do you let him go?
You can't do that.
Well, but the point is history will not be kind to that decision.
Well, speaking of that, I'll tell you who else isn't going to be kind to the Teaks. I'm afraid, what sort of vengeance might you seek on the Teaks?
Right now, there's an uneasy truth. But
right,
their pledge class next year.
Right.
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 They will have hell to pay.
Right. You're going after them.
And they will have to physically remove the russets and other things from their colon.
Oh, I see. Other forms of potato guns. Right. All right, listen, Def Rat Guy, I know it's been an emotional morning for you. I appreciate you summoning the strength to come on the show and talk about your new fraternity, Delta Fu Gamma. Again, where do you go if you want to find out information?
Def Frat Guy, of course.
DefRatGuy.com.
Is where you'd go if you want to join up the new frat.
And dude, I talked to a classic professor. He said foo is acceptable.
All I want to say is this. A lot of guys, after hearing this news, would have funneled the Sixer, Mickey's, packed up their potato gun, and slinked off into the sunset. Not that frat guy. He's starting his own frat.
Yeah. 5 years of college have taught him a little something called maturity, apparently.
Evidently. You're a brave man, Mav.
I have so much work to do.
Right. I understand. I know. It's an emotional day. Let's just break here.
And you can also get t-shirts at deafratguy.com, right?
Dude, I don't know why you even call it that.
Sorry.
You guys made up...
His name's Maverick.
Delta Foo.
His name's Maverick at Delta Foo Gamma House. We need to take ourselves a quick break. Thanks for coming in, Mav. Big Tad going to come in here.
Delta Foo!
And drop a bombshell, which I hope... doesn't mean he's going to make a kiki. He's going to drop something big. Evidently, Damashek and I are the only two guys in the building who don't know what he's going to say, but I'll be interested in finding out after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. Comedy, opinions, celebrities, news, sports, and so much more.
Let me explain the genius of Gene Simmons.
The powerful and attractive Gene Simmons.
It's like what Snoop Dogg did with pot. Snoop Dogg can smoke pot wherever Snoop wants to smoke pot because he is Snoop Dogg. Gene has done the same thing for his genitalia.
Every woman complains that none of the guys tell her the truth. So you should look into the eyes of your beloved and say, I desire you with every inch of my being, but I want your mommy and your sister too.
Yeah, I should have done it with pot and sex.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of the Adam Carolla Show.
So true. Insulting, but true. Spot on. Big Tad in studio because he has a bomb to drop.
I can't get the big applause. Thanks, buddy.
I feel as if I'm the only one who doesn't know me. It's like when the parent finds out that the kid was strung out.
Well, here's the thing.
I just want to say ahead of time.
The last guy to find out. Yes.
If this turns out, I said the earlier, if this turns out that you are, in fact, Tyra Banks in a fat suit and have been punking us for the last decade, I am going to be very angry.
There are a lot of leaks, though.
Well, here's the story.
Delighted you took him up on the offer of the handy.
Thanks, buddy. Here's the thing. I told Angie on Monday, and I asked her not to tell anybody on the show.
Mm-hmm.
But... And I wasn't going to say anything about it. And then I talked to Jimmy Kimmel, and I asked him what I should do. And he said, we definitely need to go on air with this because, A, it's pretty funny and it's pretty serious at the same time. But also, we could probably get help with this.
Wait, quick question. Is this bombshell more shocking than the fact that you have Kimmel's phone number?
That's a very good point.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. That's a cow that he can't get back into the barn. I was going to say horse, but cow, much more insulting. All right, Big Tad. What is this bombshell that everybody but me and Damashek know?
I, Big Tad, might have a kid out there.
Really?
I might have a son.
You got your box spring pregnant? Who the hell did you have sex with in order to do that?
I thought that was a prerequisite to being a father was sex.
Yeah, it is sex, actually. It was about five, six years ago. And I just got...
Papa, don't preach.
Thank you, buddy.
Wow.
I'm in trouble
How
deep.
Gay that I knew the extended Euro version of this song.
You knew it in about three notes.
Almost sad.
On Friday, I got paperwork for child support.
By paperwork, you mean
that she's asking for money.
You were served.
I was served papers for child support.
And this is a woman you were with about 5 or 6 years ago.
Yeah, what happened was... One night stand, bar. Mm-hmm. We just had fun, got drunk, went back to my house in the next room. You know, mom and dad were in the other room. I was in the next room, and... We just had a good time, and... And probably about a month and a half later, her friend comes to me at the bar... And says, I need to talk to you. She takes me outside and she says, this girl might be, this girl's pregnant and it might be yours. And I said, well, let's go get the test done. Let's go get DNA, make sure it's mine. And if it's mine, I'll be there for you. I'll do everything I need to do.
Right.
She tells me that the girl doesn't want anything from me. Mm-hmm. She doesn't want. Mm-hmm. She's gonna take care of the baby. She's gonna bring it up and she, like I said, she doesn't want anything from me. And I said, well, I'd like to get this done anyway to make sure it, if it's mine.
I'm gonna do the
and
right
she,
thing.
Yeah. Yeah. She said no. So, 9 months later, I see the girl again, and she at the same bar, and she tells me,
"Wow,
not the girl, that's your baby mama." No, not the girl. The friend. And she said, "Well, she had a baby boy, and healthy and everything." And I said, "Well, I still want to get this test done if it's mine."
Are you working at this bar, by the way, or you just spend so much time at the bar?
No, it was during that time where I was spending a lot of time at bars and stuff.
All right.
And I said, you know, I told her I want to get the test done and everything. Mm-hmm. No, I haven't even talked to this girl. I haven't talked to her in 6 years.
So do you think her friend reported back to her that you wanted to take the test?
I have no clue.
And
I
did
know.
She say the second time you saw her that she spoke to her and spoke to you, or she didn't discuss that?
She didn't discuss that.
So to the best of your knowledge, she never knew what your intentions were. Now you get the paperwork because she wants money?
Yeah, she wants money from... she wants money from me, you know, which I totally understand. Like I said, mm-hmm. if he's mine, I will do the right thing.
First mm-hmm. order of business, get her and the baby over here right now for a blood test. We got to do the paternity test right here and now.
I don't want her on the air.
We're doing the paternity test.
I will do the paternity test, but we're not. I do not want her on the air.
All right, go ahead, T.
Can I ask what might be a personal question? And I know you were probably intoxicated, but do you remember if you used protection?
We didn't use protection. I remember that because now here comes. Get the bleep ready. She. I was getting ready to. And I told her to get off. And she was like, "No." She was like, "No, no." I literally remember this. I took her and I threw her off.
Sir Walter Raleigh.
By the way, a beautiful story for the boy.
To be fair to her, it takes at least 20 minutes to get off of Big Tad. It's like yelling. If I yelled at you, get out of California now. Yeah. What's going to take a while for you to get to Nevada the border?
They send the chopper in to get you off of the top of Mount Everest. So otherwise, it
they use a cherry picker,
down.
I think, the things that pull engines out of cars with. Right. Jimmy, this is so comically tragic.
Unthinkable.
Finally, he's...
Chad called and told me yesterday he was very concerned, and I was just dying.
Well, the good news is, for the first time, there'll be little Tads running around.
Yeah, I know there's possibly one out there.
Oh, he has sex one time in 10 years, and he has a baby. By the way, this could be a great new sitcom, My Two Tads.
Well, let's try to break this down. First off, thank goodness there's DNA testing now, so we can definitively get to the bottom of this.
Right, like we won't be able to take one look at that kid and know.
Half man, half hippo.
Jimmy, I called you as a friend, man.
All right, I know, but now this is on the radio.
If I see half a Crayola sticking out of his nose, I'll know it's Big Tad's
boy.
By
the way, I wonder what he weighed when he was born, because that Natalie Imbruglia song from yesterday, Torn, is coming to mind.
Oh, yeah, you got to
dare you.
Listen, C-section. You got to go D-section if you give birth to Big Tad's kid.
You know
C,
what
not
like
big enough.
Let me just say this, is that, Adam, you know, you're expecting twins. You have to go through all this fertility process. Mm-hmm. Dr. Drew, another responsible individual, has to go through a whole thing to try to have children. Tad, one time, and...
He tried to get her off.
He tried
literally.
To throw her off. That's his birth control.
Yeah.
To throw her on the floor.
Yes, send her tumbling down a mountain of Tad.
The slowest brains have the fastest sperm, it turns out.
Direct, inverse correlation.
Yes. All right, so let's just try to do some math here. We have to do the DNA test. Now, what if this had happened before DNA testing, and she just said she thought you were the father of her child? How would it work? Would you just go to court? How would you ever be able to prove it, and how did they do it back in the day? I don't have the answer exactly. Do you know, Jimmy?
No, but I don't think it's going to take much to figure out whether it's Tad's kid or not. I mean, really, why bother even spending money on the DNA test? We just check if the kid has any tattoos and a goatee, and we'll know.
Nice tattoos.
Well, now, what happens, Big Tad, if this is, in fact, your child? And do you think you have a child? I mean, if I was asking you to bet on it right now, what odds would you give me?
I don't know, man.
Isn't the fact that she went to the trouble to get a lawyer and subpoena you and probably try to garnish your wages, doesn't that show that she's pretty confident it's yours?
Yeah.
I think Tad thinks there's a very good chance that that he has a son.
I have a better idea. Instead of doing the paternity test on this show, let's export it out to Maury Povich, the expert. Let's get Fat Tad and this lady on Maury and have it done on national TV, yes?
And make a little cash while we're at it.
That's a great idea.
Jim is on the phone. Well, Jimmy's on the phone, but Jim, caller Jim, says he can do the paternity test for Big Tad. Jim?
Yeah.
Where do you work?
It's actually my wife. She does mobile DNA testing, and I could have her there tomorrow to do the test.
Interesting. She could drive the van over and we could do it.
Now, simple cheekle swab test.
You need the cheek swab from a Big Tad and then baby. Of the child.
That's right. And it's one of the best labs in the country. It's legally admissible in courts. Mm-hmm. You can get results in as little as 24 hours.
Mm. Ooh. All right. Now, what do you say, Big Tad? Can you bring your youngin' in?
I have no idea how to get a hold of her. The paperwork has no number or anything.
Put out the Tad signal. You know what you do is open a bag of potato chips, and eventually they'll find you.
Just crinkle it.
Jimmy, come on, man.
What do you... Yeah, this is not funny, Jimmy.
It's funny. It's hilarious to Jimmy. I know that.
Right, it is funny.
Yeah, but...
What? But now, where are you supposed to send the money? To the court? And how much money do they want?
Right now,
right to the baby.
No, right now, I'm looking for a lawyer to see what I have to do, and I think I found one in Long Beach. I'm sorry, Santa Monica.
A good place to look is on billboards on the highway.
Yes. 2-2-2-2-2-2. If you see more than 5 2s, it means they're a good lawyer.
Jimmy.
The thing to keep in mind is that not all the lawyers will work with DNA labs, so you want to make sure that they're working with somebody that's going to get that cheekle swab test.
The only way to make sure this is on the up and up, let's do it on TV. Jimmy, do it on your show. If Maury won't do it.
This is a gift that comes around only every 5 or 7 years. And you really should make a whole month out of this thing. I mean, this is going to be a beautiful, beautiful event. Dad, the father.
Joe is an attorney. He's phoning in, Joe.
Hello, guys.
Hello, Joe.
I listen to your show this morning. I love it. I just felt inclined to call in this morning. I am an attorney in Beverly Hills. I handle risk management. But all my clients are corporate. I came out of a family law firm. My job is basically to keep gentlemen who own their own companies and have a number of assets from having to ever unleash those assets on any potential ex-wives or potential children. Legally.
Right. Big Tad has Beanie Babies and a Pog collection that his mom watches for him while he's gone.
Boot on his Pringles.
I'll tell you what. I came from a family law symposium last night at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and there are some attorneys there, a majority of them are women, that will take even those bean bags from him if they could feel that they can hawk half of it to pay for a note on their Lexus.
So what is Big Tad's strategy now? He had sex with someone 5-6 years ago. He just gets a letter in the mail from the court saying you're the father. What's his next move?
More than likely, it's not a private attorney. It's the district attorney's office that's handling.
Mm-hmm.
Like this woman has a lot of cash, so she did this sort of deal because no attorney takes this up without at least $5,500 up front if it's a private attorney.
Right.
The DA will just send out letters to anyone that any woman even alleges to be the father.
Right.
If you make no objections, they will not do any DNA testing. And the minute you make the first payment or any kind of monetary contribution, then what starts to happen is when you object to it, they say, well, we're going to do what's in the best interest of the child. You're the only father the child knows, so you're going to keep paying.
So DNA testing is the way to go at this point.
Yes, that is the first thing. And one thing I would advise is to zip the lip. Enough with the maybe, he's got to be mine. Yeah, zip it.
No more.
Because all of that is going to be found out. You're going to hear this record. It's going to be subpoenaed. Or you're going to hear this tape in the middle of a hearing where all you're saying is, yeah, I remember that night. No, we didn't wear condoms, yada, yada, yada.
Mm-hmm.
Wait a second. Can I ask a legal question? How can we get DNA from the baby? Can we force the baby to do a DNA test or force the mom?
You know, you can do so. I mean, I always say, you know what? Don't just, you know, always force them to prove their case. It's like if you're prosecuting, this is basically a prosecution.
Mm-hmm.
He's being charged with with committing the crime of being this kid's father. She's going to make this look as worse as possible once it does get to that courtroom or into any commissioner or judge. And
she may back off if you say you're getting a DNA test, right? Because I'm guessing this is a gal, if she's meeting Big Tad at a bar 5 years ago, going home to his parents' house and having unprotected sex with them, this is a woman that's not a virgin. You did not break her hymen that night.
She already has a kid. She had a kid from before.
And by the way, where is this bar? I want to go there. If Tad can get laid there, I want in.
And by the way, I would be right on the sign. You know,
Tad got laid here.
Yeah, they do those things like free jelly beans or over a million served. But Tad got laid here. Imagine your chances.
And here's the other thing, Tad. I'm no attorney. I speak to you from the heart. I think I completely disagree with the guy on the phone. I think you need to open your heart and your front door to this child. Do the right thing.
Well, that's part you guys are missing out on is that, you know, everyone's taking kind of the angle that, you know, how best to deny this. Tad is excited about this.
Exactly. Listen, this child, you have to, you know, sit him on your knee and teach him your life's wisdom and so on and so
Tell
forth.
Tell him about the potato chip factory and start feeding him potato chips.
All of it. He's got to move in with you.
No, honestly.
He needs a father figure.
I was impressed when you first said that when you originally heard she was pregnant, your first reaction was that you wanted to help support the baby. It's very kind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was probably BS for the radio, but
okay.
But I think Tad is a little bit excited about it, right, Tad?
Yeah, I am excited about it.
You are?
Like I said, if he's mine, then yeah.
Do you know the name?
Yeah, Isaiah.
Imagine how excited the kid's going to be, too. And by the way, how old is the kid now? Probably 5 or so?
Yes.
Isaiah is his name, he says.
Mm-hmm.
Mama named him Isaiah.
The kid's black?
No.
Well, if he is, it'll save you some money.
Well, let me just say this. I know there's some concerns when we brought Tad on board. What's he going to do? He's semi-retarded, et cetera, et cetera. But Tad never fails to delight. He really does.
Well, I tell you, he's finally providing some content for the show. That's the beauty of it.
Wait till Isaiah gets in here.
All right. Oh, yeah. We need to take ourselves a break. Jimmy Kimmel, everyone. Jimmy Kimmel Live, 12:06. ABC, Monday through
Terry
Friday.
Hatcher and Huey Lewis are on the show tonight. Oh. Dad, bring the kid.
Wow.
Hatcher and Lewis on tonight?
Yeah, that's right.
Nice.
Big night tonight.
Yes. Okay, wear two pair of underpants, by the way. Not for Hatcher, for Huey.
I gotcha.
All right. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with Big Tad in his dilemma after this.
Last Friday, with $1,000 on the line.
How do I sign off each show?
Mahalo.
Down goes Fraser!
Mo Damashek, you are the queen of all moms.
But then, an unexpected twist.
Mo has generously not accepted the $1,000.
No.
It will roll over in the kitty and be worth
$2,000
next week.
So that means this Friday, someone's going to walk away with $2,000. And all you got to do to win is beat Dave's mom. Will someone win the cash? Or will Mo Damashek get another chance to feed the kitty? Find out Friday on The Adam Carolla Show.
I can feel Fat Tad a-coming, 'cause he weighs 400 pounds. Every time he starts walking, his footsteps shake the ground. He's got a head the size of a pumpkin, and a smell that'll knock you down. He's Big Fat Sweaty Tad, you better hide your food when he's around.
Well, as if Big Tad couldn't get any lower now, he finds out he may have an illegitimate child floating around out there.
Lowry now has a reason for being. Young Isaiah, 5
yes.
years of age.
Big Tad. Big Tad, Jimmy and I met many years ago. Jimmy fell in love with Big Tad.
Yep.
As far as I go, the jury's still out.
Hey, wait a minute.
But Jimmy fell in love with Big Tad, and we took him under our collective wings many years ago when we were on K-Rock doing morning radio. He fell out of favor with the folks over there when me and Kimmel left, but he got back in with Kimmel doing a man show and then Jimmy Kimmel show. Then he went out and he fell in. He had some trouble. He got some DUIs. He did some boozing. He made some mistakes. During a low point, He was at a bar that he frequented when he was doing a lot of drinking, and at a low point, met a woman, had a one-night stand at your parents' house with your folks in the next room.
Yeah.
Wow. And listen, and here's the thing, Tad. There's nothing stealthy or covert about you. You are not a ninja.
No.
You are a bull in a china shop. I could only imagine a Tad loaded, bringing home a chick that must have been loaded, and I'm guessing no pixie herself.
She is very cute. I do remember that.
She's a Latina.
Why would a cute chick have a one-night stand with you? Did she know you as Big Tad from the radio?
No. You guys put this ugly thing on me. I've actually had some hot girlfriends, if you remember.
Yes, but you get some overflow at some station event or something. If you hang out by the van and hand out calendars, you may get a little something.
That was one time when we did that.
I'm talking about non-station related sex.
Non-station, I do have girls come up to me and think I'm cute.
And so she was cute.
Yes.
And not a wide load herself.
No.
A Latina, you say?
Yes.
Came back, had sex with you, and that was 5 years ago. She's possibly pregnant now. I have a call here. Shanna says she's friends with the woman we're speaking of. Shanna?
I'm here.
You say you're the best friend of the alleged mom?
Yes, I am.
Mm-hmm. What's her name?
Come on.
Well, we have to label
first
her
name.
Something. First
am I
name.
Allowed to say?
Yeah.
Gina.
Oh.
Yes.
Yep, she knows him.
All right. That is true. And you know young Isaiah?
Yes, I do.
How old is Isaiah?
He's about 5.
About 5?
Yeah.
All right. And do you know what Big Tad looks like?
Yes, I do.
And what about Isaiah?
Isaiah looks just like him.
He has a hat on backwards? Some terrible tattoos?
A beard?
Yeah, we knew Tad before he was even on the radio.
Mm-hmm. So you say, really seriously, you say his potential son looks a lot like him.
Yes.
Is he heavy set?
Not really. Mm. No, not really. He's, Gina's Hispanic, mm-hmm. and Isaiah looks just like him. That's mm-hmm. pretty much all I could say. It looks just like him.
So you essentially a Mexican Big Tad.
I'm sorry?
A Mexican Big Tad.
Kind of. But he's white.
Oh, he's white.
Well,
she's Mexican, I'm white.
Right, so at least half.
Half.
A grande.
Yes.
Senior Gordo. Tad. Grande Gordo.
Yeah, Isaiah looks more like Tad than Gina.
Mm-hmm.
What, do you know, if I can ask you, why is Gina bringing this up now after 5 years?
You know, I don't know. This is a shock to me.
Mm-hmm. Do you think you could get hold of Gina for us?
I could.
And,
have her call in?
Well, I don't know how she feels about it, but I don't think it's a secret. She served Big Tad some papers. She wants some money. I think Big Tad has the right to know if he's the father or not. I don't see why. And now, is she in a relationship? Is she married?
No.
She's single?
Yes.
Maybe we could get these two kids back together.
Wait.
Yeah, for the little tadpole.
Yes. From what I heard, a friend... Can we turn this down, please?
Yes.
I had a friend come to one of my appearances last week. Shanna, is this the girl that was at the bar with me?
Yes.
Okay, so your boyfriend...
My husband, Eddie?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, your husband came last week and said that she had a boyfriend. She's living with somebody.
Yeah, but she's not married.
Oh.
Yeah, she actually just moved in with this guy.
Yeah.
If she was married, she probably couldn't get the financial assistance.
Interesting. And she has other children from other folks?
Yeah, she has one other daughter from about 8-9 years ago.
That's from phone screener Brian.
Now, Shanna, you know I was cool about this back in the day, because I did say that I wanted to get everything taken care of.
Yeah.
But mm-hmm. why did she not want to do it back then?
I don't know. She says, as far as I know, that you know, at the time you didn't want a child, and she... Mm-hmm. You know, she just tried to keep it from you, so that way, you know, you can go on with what you were doing.
Shanna, that's her name, Shanna?
By the way.
I think you owe some money, too, because how you didn't get in Gina's way and say, what in hell are you thinking, lady? Really, Fat Tad, you can't do better? We're out of here.
On.
You clearly are three sheets to the wind. We're out of here,
no,
girl.
Were they together at the bar the night Tad and Gina met?
Were they together?
Were you with Gina?
Were you with Gina?
They ended up having a one-night stand, yes.
Yes, but you weren't there that night.
I think I was.
You were at the bar.
See, you're culpable. You're responsible to get in the way of this sort of terrible decision making.
Yeah, as part of the sisterhood, you might have
stepped in. I've personally had those dude maintain conversations with my buddies many times.
How does that go?
Well, they're slinking off with some manity, and I pull them aside and say, listen, dude, I don't know if you got some GHB in your system. I don't know what's going on, but this woman is a cow. You believe me, I'm not as loaded as you are. Now, dude, maintain! And then I will then throw duct tape around them, bind them, and throw them in the trunk of my car.
That's a good friend.
Sorry, Big Dad.
This is why it's so important to spay and neuter. You're stupid.
All right, so Shanna.
Yes.
What I'm going to ask you to do is get hold of your friend Gina.
Okay.
So we can talk to her and straighten this out, because we're looking for clarity and closure.
I understand.
And Tad's on cloud nine, too, by the way. Cloud nine, by the way, apparently supports more weight than I realized.
I thought he was on cloud 10.
Well, he takes two clouds. Yes. He's on cloud 9, 10, and part of 11. All right, Shanna, I'm going to put you on hold.
Okay.
We need to take a break.
Okay.
Talk Gina into talking to us.
Okay.
And maybe she doesn't have a problem with it. Big Tad just wants to make right. That's all he wants.
Okay.
We'll put you on hold. We'll do our best to talk to Gina. We have sports, we have news, we have our guitar rock off all coming up. All seems trivial now compared to Big Tad and his dilemma.
Congratulations.
Yes, little tadpole.
Yes, as Gina's people say, mazel tov, my friend.
But very quickly, just to review, Gina has a child who's 8 years old. She met you, had a one-night stand with you in her parents' place. Again, definitely not a Jew, yes?
Definitely not a Jew.
Definitely not. All right, we'll take a break. Hopefully, we'll talk to the mother of Big Tad's love child after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. If you can think of a better way to wake up, we'd like to hear it.
Big Tad went on a date last night. What base did Tad get to?
It was a really good makeout, maybe a little bit more, but that was that.
Little bosom. You felt Tad's bosom?
She
reached back, undid Tad's bra. One hand. No struggling.
If you keep listening, he'll keep talking. The Adam Carolla Show.
This is Quagmire. You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show.
Well, we tried to get Gina, the mother of Big Tad's love child, on the phone. We were not successful. She evidently is at work. We will continue this, though, Big Tad.
Okay.
I think tomorrow we'll get her on the phone and figure out this.
Little Isaiah's been running around the world for 6 years. What's an extra day or two?
Yeah, he can make it without Papa Tad. All right, Dad. Dad.
No, it's Tad.
All right, Big Dad. Go see what the Iron Sheik is up to on the internet. We will now move forward with the show with Teresa Strasser and the news.
Immigration still in the news. Yesterday, the Senate approved construction of a 370-mile triple-layer fence along the Mexican border. Mm-hmm. The fence is going to cost an estimated $900 million. And when I read triple-layer fence, I didn't know what that was, and I figured you might.
Well, the first layer traps the Mexican. The second separates it.
Right.
And the third brings it back to its mother of Mexico. Yeah, I don't know. I just think about diapers and things whenever I think triple layer.
Yeah,
I think about
it's
adult
trapping
diapers.
Moisture.
Yeah. I would sell it to the Mexicans as we're trying to keep Whitey out of your country.
I understand Gina, Tad's Latina lover, is having a triple border installed on her Mexican border. So
She should have had a triple layer condom.
Yes. Would have been nice.
That would have been good. In entertainment news on American Idol last night, it's down to the final two. Here's Ryan Seacrest rather tactfully telling one of the contestants that it's over.
Let's look at the lowest percentage. 33.06%. Who is so close to going on but is going home tonight? Let's see it now. Elliot Yamin.
33. They all got 33%.
Yeah, it was something like 0.2% he was away from, I assume, McPhee. We don't know for sure.
Yeah, now why do you assume?
I just, because I don't like her.
Yeah, I don't like her either, but not because I don't like her. I don't like people for two reasons. Either I just don't like them, they're a-holes, or they're too perfect.
That's why I don't like her. She makes me feel like a troll with no talent.
Yeah, and I don't feel like I could ever hump her. And anyone I feel that way about.
I just learned a lot.
That's why I love you, baby. Yeah, she opens her mouth. There's no fillings in her teeth. She doesn't seem to have a pore in her skin. Mm-hmm. She's 20 and completely composed and at ease with the situation. And then there's her dad out there bawling his eyes out every time his daughter belts out
happy,
a tune.
Happy, intact family, talented.
Oh, supportive. Mom's a voice coach. Dad couldn't love his daughter more. It sickens
me. I don't need
me.
It. I prefer Pickler, whose father just got out of jail.
That's what I like.
Okay, an 80-year-old Iowa woman just got a new tattoo. Not a butterfly or a rose, but the words, "Do not resuscitate." While the woman is still in good health at 80, as a nurse, she says she's seen it all and wants to die with dignity. And though she has a living will, she hopes the ink will eliminate any doubt.
Trying to think of this song.
Suicide Blonde, I
Suicide.
Think.
Suicide. Oh, see? Keeps me sharp. Yeah, I like that. That's cool. That's
DNR,
hardcore.
Right on the chest.
Yeah.
So there's no mistaking it.
Yeah, my grandma just has one of those comedy and tragedy masks on each one of her boobs. What the hell's that?
Probably have lost a bet.
Yeah.
After 8 years on the air, Will and Grace will air its final episode tonight. It was the first primetime gay-themed comedy to become a huge commercial success.
Yeah. Thank God they came. They were on the air, too, because before Will and Grace, I didn't know what gays were.
Had
I remember
no
I've talked to people, and they'd be like, yeah, hey, you're so gay. And I'd be like, what does that mean? Happy? And they'd say, no. There's this thing where males and females... the same sex get together and have intercourse. And I was like, what? No way. Never heard of that. And then I was able to watch a sitcom and it opened up my eyes. It really did. It knocked down a lot of barriers.
I learned what I needed to know from Jack Tripper and company.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Well, he was pretending to be gay. Right. Also, before I saw a positive depiction of gays, I would just go out, round them up, and drag them behind my pickup truck. I had
Will
no idea that they were human beings.
Right.
Because of Will and Grace, I found out they live in apartments, they have furniture.
They're witty.
They're witty. They're just like you and I.
Well, the finale
except for the glory
tonight.
Hole part.
Exactly. Right. I'm Teresa Strasser, gloriously, and that's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Well, my head's spinning right now. You know, the glory of life. You know, Fat Tad's big news in sharp relief with the death of my dream. Chichu versus Temu, Ducks versus Sharks. The dream is over. I just am getting, my heart's not in it. I'm just going to move as quickly as I can and say, tonight at the Staples Center, game six between the Suns and Clippers. Suns lead at 3-2, so the Clippers better win or they're done. 7-0 in the PM at Staples Center tonight. Blah, blah, blah. Who gives a crud today? Right. All I'll say is Edmonton eliminated the Sharks and Chichu last night, 2-0. The dream is over. No Chichu versus Temu.
Well, he can go back to his beloved Moose Knuckle now and begin playing golf, wherever the hell he's from.
So long, Chichu.
You're going to miss him.
I think this says it all.
Will I know your names? If they're not Chichu or Temu, will I watch the games without Chichu and Temu? I must be strong and root Temu on.
Are you okay?
But I know it would be wrong.
Without
Chichu.
Just don't say anything.
Some people just need to be left alone when they're hurting.
So long, Chichu. Yeah. So long.
We're going to miss him.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right. Well, I've already recovered. We're going to have a little guitar off in here. We got three guys. They've all brought their electric guitars. All capable. All professional. Look at these guys.
Yeah.
They look like they
rockers.
Rock. They got to play this riff. They're going to win themselves
from Soundgarden in there.
They're going to win themselves $1,000 worth of a Gibson guitar. Also, they'll be going to the Cars and Blondie over at the amphitheater. We used to call it the Universal Amphitheater. I think it's now the Gibson Amphitheater right here in my hometown. We'll take a quick break. We'll start in on that after this.
Last Friday, an Adam Carolla Show trivia with $1,000 on the line.
How do I sign off each show?
Mahalo.
Mo Damashek, you are the queen of all moms.
Then, an unexpected twist.
Mo has generously not accepted the $1,000. No. It will roll over in the kitty and be worth $2,000.
Oh. Wow.
Next week.
So that means tomorrow, someone's going to walk away with $2,000. And all you got to do to win is beat Dave's mom. Will someone win the cash, or will Mo Damashek get another chance to feed the kitty? We're going to find out tomorrow morning on the Adam Carolla Show. Someone's going to win front row tickets to the new Cars and Blondie Saturday night at Gibson Amp and a Gibson SG Special electric guitar.
To me, it doesn't matter whether you play the middle riff, the end riff, the beginning riff. We'll either dig it or we won't. Just rock and we'll take you in. Do you play the guitar?
No.
We got an axe to grind. Ooh, Adam doesn't like that. We're going to give away a guitar right now on the Adam Carolla Show.
That's right. $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar. Ricky, Gustav, and Raph all here representing.
Representing.
Everyone had some time to hang out, press the flesh. Feeling good? Everyone seems like they're going to be fun, a good competitor. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right. So everyone brought their own guitar, but they'd like to walk away with this Gibson. Now, did you guys know this song before I made the decree we need to play this song?
No. Actually, I called yesterday afternoon and left a message for Angie because I didn't remember what the name of the song was.
Well, it's a Chuck Berry song.
Thank you, Angie, by the way.
Called Wasn't Me. And it wasn't, I guess George Thorogood went ahead. Do we have it, actually, Brian? George Thorogood went ahead and remade it at some point. And I hate Bad to the Bone. I think that song is totally effed out. They play too much on the radio. But this is a George Thorogood song I like. I don't care if it's a remake. Does a good job with it. And I thought, well, we did sort of a heavy metal angle last time we gave away one of these. Why not do a little rock and roll or even rockabilly? So
it's an interesting thing, too, that the three competitors seem to embody different eras of guitar guy. You know, like a Raph looks like Kim Thayil, like I said, from Soundgarden.
Yeah.
Gustavo looks sort of like a 50s rocker, you know, with the hair, the bouffant hair.
He's one of the crickets.
And Ricky sort of looks like Frank Black with a goatee.
He's more of a roach, but yeah.
Oh, hey.
Yes, the rockers come in many forms, and we have all of them here today. All right. So, who wants to start? Ricky, you want to start?
I can do that, sure.
Why don't you go plug yourself into the amp? And again, this is not really, it's not the compulsory part of the ice skating. This is the freestyle. This is the template you have to work off of. But ultimately, whoever rocks the most, we're going to take.
We want to know something about Ricky here.
That's right. All right. So Ricky's setting up his guitar, then Gustavo's going to step in, and then Raph will step in. You guys all play your riffs, and then we'll go to commercial. We'll figure it out, and the winner's going to walk away with the guitar and the Cars and the Blondie tickets as well. All right, you ready to go, Ricky?
I'm ready.
All right, let's hear it. Didn't know the song, did you, Ricky?
Yeah.
All right. All right. A solid effort. Ricky, sit your fat ass down. Gustav is coming up next.
So I need to follow that?
That was
awesome.
That was solid, but I still think we got better in this room.
Ricky, by the way, are you playing the exact same guitar as the one that we're giving away? I mean, that's the same type of guitar? It looks exactly alike.
Sorry. No, I'm not. It's very similar to it.
All right.
This is a 61 reissue. That's a...
I wish I could play the guitar because they're the coolest things to collect. Because they're sort of part tool and part furniture. You know, there's a part of them that just looks like kinetic sculpture. And then there's a part of them that actually has a function and form part. They're just the coolest thing to see hanging on your wall.
You know, you're not born, though, with the ability to play guitar. You could learn it if you wanted to.
It's like, you know, they say that with Spanish and other languages. Shine that noise, dude.
See?
I'm watching TiVo. Yeah. All right, Gustavo, what do you have for us?
Do we get to sing, too?
Sure, if you like.
Oh. Do a Chi-Chu song.
Help. Oh, that nice. could help or hurt. I want you to know right now.
Hurt.
Fish Tank likes it.
All right, Gustavo, rock out. The singing part.
Sure.
Yeah, do a little Chi-Chu song for us.
Chi-Chu, how about a little Elvis?
How about a little Elvis, but you have to work Chi-Chu into the fold. Love me, Chi-Chu. Well, that's all right, Chi-Chu. That's all right for you. That's all right, Chi-Chu. That's any way you do, well, that's Chi-Chu. Well, that's Chi-Chu. That's Chi-Chu. Yeah, solid. All right. You helped your cause, Gustavo.
It feels good to laugh.
Record, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It doesn't seem like that should be factored in, but it's when they do that thing in court where the guy stands up and yells, "I'm guilty, you should fry me," and then the judge says, please have that removed from the...
Stricken from the record. You can't unring that bell.
You can't unring the bell. Yes, that's exactly right.
This judge thinks otherwise.
Go ahead, Raph.
Yes, Raph, I can tell, by the way. Raph, you can tell, is quietly confident. He's got this one in the bag.
Yeah, he knows.
I don't know if there's anything quiet about that shirt. A nice job. I'm going to give you the same bonus opportunity. If you can sing or do a favorite song of yours and work either Chi-Chu or Temu or both into it, there'll be extra points awarded.
Wow, without hesitation.
You don't have a sign here.
Chi-Chu. Solid. Ricky.
Yes.
Stairway to Hockey.
I
was going to give you a chance to do a Chi-Chi or Temu song, but then you gave me that super creepy yes, and I decided to go to commercial.
Oh.
All right, do you have anything that comes to mind?
I can't get David out of his Chi-Chu.
I'll take that as a no. All right, we need to deliberate now. Thanks for that, Breskin. We'll take a quick break.
I'll say you.
We'll be back to figure out the winner of this Gibson guitar after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. There's a lot more coming up, so stay here.
We went and pulled a scene from When Harry Met Sally. That frat guy, I guess you're going to be Harry.
Hell yeah.
And Sabina, you'll be Sally.
Okay.
Here we go.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that feels
great. Like that. Keep going.
Oh, that was so good.
Hell yeah.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of the Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. Enjoy this riff so much. So that's George Thorogood doing a little Chuck Berry. We brought in Ricky, Gustav, and Raph.
Unfortunately, you didn't hear it today.
No, but
he's hearing it now.
Close.
Yeah, this took George Thorogood many takes, I'm sure. All right, now everyone got to do their bonus Chichu song except for Ricky. Ricky?
Hello, good morning.
Are you plugged in?
I am plugged in.
Would you like to quickly give us your bonus Chichu Tamu song?
Wait, let me...
He's putting his head down.
I thought this was supposed to be taken care of before.
Brisket. Why don't you put that on his head?
Diva.
Okay.
Ooh. Little Ziggy Stardust.
Chichu played hockey. Skating good with the San Jose Sharks. He could skate out, skate Timu. Oh, did I blow that part?
No, that was... Well, yeah, but...
Keep going. We would have never noticed.
All too far. But he could skate real far. So help me out, David. So where were the spectators?
Everybody. It still hurts too much for me to sing about Chichu.
Yeah. Let me tell you something. When a guy with a crazy name in a city you don't live in gets thrown out of a playoffs in a sport you don't care about, it breaks off into five phases. First denial.
Right.
It's
going to
take a long time till my heart's right.
Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, stages of grief.
That's right. She's getting into acceptance and then grieving.
Denial,
and
numbness.
Then we'll hit anger by next Wednesday.
Yeah Ricky, scary. Back
Teresa's
off.
What?
All right.
Teresa's into self-help.
Ricky, Gustav, and Raph, let's see who's going to win. Again, the Gibson guitar. Also, you get tickets for the new Cars and Blondie over at the amphitheater, the Gibson Amphitheater, over at Universal City Walk. Well, I'm going to include my cohorts on this one. I liked everyone, by the way. They're
thank you.
No losers.
Thank
no
you.
Losers.
Gracias. Yeah, they all gave a great effort.
Everyone gave a great effort. I would, I'd have to say Raph, I think, is the man who did the best job today.
I'm going to ask some of my friends. How say you, Fish Tank? They go with Raph.
They're going with Raph.
They like the stairway thing a lot.
Yeah, was nice. We put him on the spot and he came through. Yes.
As the Paula of the group, I want to say that as a woman, that's a great shirt.
It's not just one shirt. It's like 11 shirts.
You look phenomenal. You look phenomenal. I think you played from the heart. I was moved and you were also my favorite.
Okay.
Thank you.
Wow. Clean, sweet.
Nothing, not to take anything away from Gustavo or Ricky, but you guys sucked.
Oh, thank you. I know you mean that from the bottom of your heart.
No, you guys were great. It's just Raph was that much greater. So, Raph, you are the winner.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
but it's a beautiful guitar. You cannot paint that beautiful guitar, that mahogany guitar, that ridiculous concoction of Van Halen paint colors you have spread all over your current
guitar. Yes, because Raph's guitar looks like spring break circa 1988. Yeah. It's a disaster.
The kid's toy where you spin the paint?
Yeah. Yeah. It's tie-dyed, essentially.
Spin art. It's like a clown vomited on a piece of mahogany.
Don't blow it. Raph,
you're hurting your... Raph, I'm this close to taking the guitar away and hitting you with it. El Kabong style. All right, play us off the air, would you there, Raph? The rest of you will be able to go and see the new Cars and Blondie over at the amphitheater.
Thanks, Adam.
Thank you, Adam.
No, thank you, guys.
Hey,
great job.
Thanks for having us.
Our pleasure. CeCe DeVille in here tomorrow. Joe Gannascoli, Gay Vito, Bobby Lee from MTV. Also, $2,000 worth of trivia coming up. See if anyone can knock Mo Damashek off her high horse. Alan Covert, Doug Hall, American inventor. And until next time, this is Adam saying, mahalo.